Everybody, Yasmin, Nightbot, Synthesizer Sam, Grungy, Past Tense Bandit. Yo, what's up? Today we're doing part two of our exploration into learning how to be a bartender. Last time we covered vodka and just the general basics about what the tools are and how to wipe the countertops and things like that and what kind of ice there is. But mostly vodka, learning about how there's a million different ways to make vodka. Out of potatoes, out of corn, out of rye, out of wheat. Anything that can be made into a mash, you can make it to a vodka. Today, it's all about gin and whiskey. My mother thought that it was rum. I thought that it was rum. But I'm gonna not do that one yet. Because I'm really excited about that one. And so I'm waiting. So I'm doing the two that I don't care about that much. I don't think I've had enough gin in my life to even know if I like it. I would have this thing down here be drink tequila rose now. I have tequila rose in my fridge. However, it's definitely expired. It's gotta be. It's been in my freezer, but it says that it's good 6 months after opening. I've had it so much longer than 6 months. It's been open a lot longer than 6 months, so I don't trust it. It's gotta be expired, no way. And I barely touch expired anything, especially something that maybe has milk in it. I feel like it might. Alcohol never expires. No, I don't trust tequila rose, okay? Have you had it? It's like very creamy. It's strawberry. No way, no way. And I don't deal with expired milk of any sort. I just don't, yeah. So today's been my day off. It's been really lovely. Yesterday on Law and Order, I spent half of the day knitting a new scarf, so that was cool. And then the second half of the day lasted forever. If it's creamy, then never mind. Yes, correct. Like, if let me show you what this looks like. It's my favorite alcohol, my favorite bottled alcohol that you can buy at the store. And it looks like this. It's gorgeous. It's cute. It's pink. Like, if Yasmin drinks alcohol, have you had this? I feel like you would fall in love. But I'm also a big fan of tequila, I think. So, I don't even see how this is tequila. It doesn't taste like tequila. It tastes like strawberry cream. But I'm glad that it's tequila and not vodka or something. I think Char's trying to get us drunk. I want to get drunk. I want to get drunk. But listen, here's what just happened. I paid utilities and my February rent for the new place on top of the security deposit for the new place, which is the cost of the rent. So I'm in a place right now. Grunge can't do tequila. That's such a shame. That's such a shame because I think it's the most delicious of all of them. Sedge Conrado, hi. It's nice to see you. I'm just giving it a few moments for my mom to type in chat. I feel like she might be here right now taking her makeup off, but run downstairs, mother. Run downstairs. I need to know that you're here because she told me to wait an hour to stream so that she could be here and learn with us and correct me if I have wrong opinions. Hi, it's mom. No, I need Sweet Tea 27 here. Well, so do I, Char. Rub it in, why don't you? Yeah. I am. I'm rubbing it in. I would actually touch the lens, but this is my new camera, so I don't want to get it dirty. Does it look nice? I feel like I'm fixing things up. I'm finally learning how to deal with the camera. Like, it was delayed before. Because it was set to 4K, but I set it to 180p, and now it seems to be right on time, which is nice. I finally replaced the light bulb in my room, so I'm no longer relying on my ring light. So if it looks brighter in here, that's that. What kind of wrong opinions? More like questions I ask that she could answer. Because last time we did this, I was like, what is this made out of? She's like, it's this, but she was watching the VOD. It's me. I am sweet, whatever. It's me. Nuh-uh. Just because you're VIP, everybody looks pink in chat right now. Is that just me? Is my whole chat like pinks and purples? Because it looks really cute. Yes, I need you to come in here and add to that, please. Please tell me you're still here. Yes, I love you. I did not consent for you to rub my eye like that. Well, you just said rub it in, so I did. I feel like your mom would type in chat every letter with her index finger. I'm trying to think if that's the kind of person she is. No, I don't think so. My mom's handwriting is so good. Like, she takes her sweet time.
Going into the negatives for this one, heart.
What does that mean? Going into the negatives. What does that mean? Yo, we're at a year. Oh my god, we're at a year, Hayden. How did that just happen? No, that's a lie. Oh my god. Yeah, I was like, it was not computing. 18 months, that's way better. What the heck? 12-month streak. Very cute. Going into the negatives, it means I'm poor until Monday. Yo, we're all poor. Yes, Hayden, let's go. Poor gang, rise up. Dry January. Dry January learning about bartending. Let's go. Sam. Synthesizer Sam is here. Non-pink username. I mean, the green looks really cute. Hayden's purple. No, he's purple, so that works too. It's cute. The colors in here are just really bright and pastel-y, kind of neon. It's really adorable. It's like Lisa Frank. Also, rip Lisa Marie Presley. That hurt. That almost hurt as much as Robin Williams for me. I know that might sound insane, but that's true for me. But I'm pink with a hint of blood of our enemies. Yeah, it is like that kind of pink.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Good timing for that gif. Yeah, mom, put something in my chat. Oh, I'm sorry, brooding. Did you not know? Whoops. Sorry. Oh, I'm just looking at this tequila rose. It looks very good. Oh! Are you gonna make me... Are you gonna make me leave my house? Oh, frick. I have to leave my house now! I mean, luckily it's right next door. It's right next door, but you guys, it's so funny. Okay, I just got... All right, I'm getting the tequila rose. Oh, mom, you're here. Mom, don't worry. You got a few minutes still because I have to go out and buy tequila rose right now. Right is now. Go before you start. I know. I'm going to get very tipsy while learning about this. Do you think I'll retain the information? Let's see. Taking that off the table real quick. Bam, bam. New channel redemptions. A few of them. Yasmin already claimed one of them. Yeah, what was I saying? Yeah, new channel redemptions. One of them I'm very happy about. It's no being down bad for the rest of stream. And that includes if I have a guest on. Oh my god, Hayden, why would you do that? I mean, I can do that one. I don't mind it now because my room is relatively clean. I would love to move my webcam and show it off. But it's set up so perfectly. Like my bed, for instance. All it has on it is my scarf currently. Have I ever shown this part of my room on stream? Who knows? Who knows? There she be. Yeah, that's my yarn and bag full of yarn. Let's go. Hold on. Before I go, there was this video I saw that said, if you say the word rise up lights, if you say rise up lights, it's razor blades in Australian. You're welcome. Rise of blights. Oh, well, the letter is gone. The letter is gone? Yeah, the letter is gone because I'm so behind. I'm going to write the old ones, but listen, I have to be done with those ones for now. Yeah, great. You can focus on that while I leave my house and then clean my room. So get cozy, get yourself a nice drink, and we're all gonna get up in here with your notepads and your pens, and we're gonna learn about gin, and we're gonna learn about whiskey, and I'm gonna get 2 certificates out of this. I do know the beer can one. That was the one I knew way before that. Beer can. Beer can. Beer can. Beer can. Bacon. And Jamaican. It's beer can and British is bacon and Jamaican, Hayden. Just so you know. All right. Mwah. Leaving you so soon? I would love to switch to my phone and take you on this journey, but I don't think I can do that. So, all right. You got some time. You got some time. We're all getting drunk. Okay, bye. So the greatest thing just happened. All right. I went to the place, which is legitimately right next to my house. Not even kidding. Hi, Mike, by the way. And I was like, where's the tequila rose? And he said, it's right here. We also have this, which is the same bottle of tequila rose, but comes with this, and it's the same price. I present to you this cute little gift box, and it comes with two shot glasses. Look at how adorable it is! So I'm going to pretend that Grunge gifted me this really awesome gift box of tequila rose. I can't even. It's so cute. Yeah, I know it's best when it's frozen, but I just bought it, so, like, lay off. This is so cool. My goodness. Merry Christmas to me. Like the whole, all the decoration, look at how cute it is. For real. It tells you, like, all these really cute, sweet drinks on the back, and they're actually good as a person who doesn't really like alcohol that much. Like, if you like milkshakes and stuff, this could be for you. Okay, I actually have to make the drink before we start it, but Grunge stole my gift idea then. Let's open it on the stream, because otherwise I'm just going to leave you by yourselves again. What do you guys do? Yo, crazy party. Oh my god, no, I was hoping I wouldn't rip it. Happy generic winter holidays. Yeah, happy January holidays. These shot glasses are so cute. Like, I can give them to my new roomies. I could. Or I'll keep them to myself. I love milkshakes. Good. Got a Kahlua gift pack like that. Yeah, I can't believe it's the same price. Opening this without breaking anything. I feel like I'm opening a Barbie. Same packaging. There she is. Fresh bottle. Keep them? Bam. Bam! Best drink. Yes. Oh, look at that. I didn't see the other side of the shot glass. Come on. How do I get this out? Put them with your Phantom one. I got you. Got it. Specifically meant for tequila rose strawberry cream, which is fine. I have the other one right here. At least one of the other ones, my Phantom shot glass. I don't have any shot glasses this size, so this is great. This is really great. Do I serve my current drink in this? I'll have to re-get more as time goes on. But maybe I'll pour it in here, and then I'll put it in the freezer. And then when I'm done with this, then I'll get more. And it'll be more and more cold as the night goes on. How about that? Cool. Glass number one. Glass number. Come on. Glass number two. Yes, yes, yes! I know, I'd let you all have the second one. If you were really here with me right now. This won't take me as long as what it just took me to go buy that, but BRB. Go to the bathroom or whatever you need to do. Excuse me. Oh, Char said she's pretending the rose gave fuck. She got very angry. I never thought about it. I'm joking on air. Thank you, Yaz, for the channel points. I will keep extending that until it is fulfilled. Yeah. It's true. Look at this beauty. It matches everything. It matches my headphones. It matches my jacket right now. It matches all of you guys' pink names. Yep, this is the drink that messes me up. Like, because it's so good. It's one of the only drinks that I think is so good that I'll drink it and not be aware that it's alcohol, kind of. But I do mix it with milk to dilute it a little bit. And especially if you put, like, a tiny little spoonful of French vanilla creamer in there. Perfect. Perfect! So if you spill it on yourself, nobody will even know. True! Imagine sipping from a shot glass. Not the first time I've done it, alright? You know what it reminds me of? Does anybody know that video? It's one of my favorite videos, where there's this... there's this girl who's so drunk, and they give her a shot glass of water, and they're like, here you go. And she drinks it thinking that it's a shot of vodka or something. And like, how was it? And she's like, divine. And they're like, that's how you know you're drunk, because that was water. She's like, oh, you bitch. That's what it reminds me of. So, let's go to the page talking about gin. We're gonna learn today. Come with me. Char can get drunk enough for the both of us. I don't think I'm going to get that far, am I? I have to be able to retain what I'm learning. Hey, no, hydro homies in here. Not controversial. Not even in the slightest. Alrighty. We are looking for gin basics. I noticed beer basics. That's a whole hour, basically. Whiskey basics. Gin cocktails. No, not that one. Vodka basics. And basics. Here we go. I like how they're professionals at that specific type of alcohol.
We all know gin, the clear spirit that's best friends with tonic water. In this gin basics course, we're going to go through everything you need to know about gin, how it's made, what goes into it. In this lesson, we're going to be looking at the brief history of gin and some of its most memorable milestones. Gin has been around for a long, long time. In fact, over 1,000 years.
All right, I guess I should put a little thing up here that says gin on my notepad so I know what I'm talking about. Gin! Oh, it's Dutch! I love that. Mom's like, I hate gin. But I love the Dutch, so. Sounds like controversial opinion is a controversial opinion. Yeah. Huh. That's not. Jennifer sounds way prettier than gin. After the Brits adopted it?
Of course they did. Around 1689 is when William of Orange came over and became known as William III. It was he who decided that it would be great for all of us Brits to start focusing on distillation. This was a really important time for a gin industry. Although gin started life with great intentions, it would soon go south. By the end of the 17th century, there were only 6 million people living in the UK, yet there were 11 million gallons of gin being produced a year. That's more than 2 pints of gin per male adult per week. By the 1730s, things had escalated even further.
I'm writing these down. Sorry about the pausing. But we're here to learn. We're here to get certificates and then maybe apply for some jobs too. 1730. All right. Man, that's a lot of That's like the weed shops in New York City right now. History repeats itself.
Further, there are over 7,000 gin shops in the UK alone. And at some point, someone thought it'd be a good idea to start taxing it. Well, that didn't work out too well either. In 1736, the tax laws came
in. Dad knows I'm streaming.
And what did that mean for gin production? It went...
1736, gin tax began. Cool.
And underground. And that's when things really truly started to go wrong. Gins were being made with anything and everything, including, of course, lead baths, which we would go on to know as bathtub gin.
Okay, wait. So he said that gin can be made in anything as opposed to vodka, which can be made from anything, right? Just gonna back up because what?
Baths, which...
No. A little further.
Yeah. ...started to go wrong. Gins were being made with anything and everything.
Made with anything. Lead baths. Ah, shoe gin.
Thing, including, of course, lead baths, which we would go on to know as bathtub gin.
Have you guys heard of bathtub gin?
This was known as the gin craze. Essentially, with illegal gins being made all over the country, people were falling ill. Gins made in baths made of lead created some horrible, horrible diseases. And the amount of gin being consumed led to people literally falling dead in the streets. And the mothers were actually abandoning their babies. That situation went on to be known as Mother's Ruin.
Wow. This is quite a different story from vodka.
But things didn't seem to get much better. There were a few famous phrases that came out of that period of time, literally from people passing out. The lead poisoning would have people out cold for days. These bodies were often thrown into the graves, and at some point, when unearthed, they saw scratch marks on the inside of the coffins. People were so dead drunk, they appeared to be dead, but in fact weren't. This is when we came to understand the term a dead ringer. A string would be attached to the wrist of the bodies when they were buried at night, and a bell was above ground. If they woke up from their horrible drunken slumber, the bell would ring. The graveyard worker would come and dig them up to avoid certain death.
Yep.
After all that chaos, doom, and gloom, something had to change. So in seven...
Hold on. I'm pretty sure that George Washington had this fear, right? Was it George Washington? It was one of the presidents. I think it was Washington. He had a fear about being buried alive and then nobody coming to save him when he rings the bell.
In 1751, we issued the Gin Act.
Gin Act. When are we going to have our Weed Act?
What essentially that meant was a license had to be had by a distiller so that everyone knew when they were buying their gin, they had guaranteed quality. And thank God that came into play. Not only did gin become legalized, but it became a serious art. Those early families from Beefeater to Gordon's to Tanqueray went on to produce some incredible spirits. And the gin category has continued to grow. Gin's now consumed as one of the finest spirits in all of the world. A perfect blend of different herbs and botanicals make this one of the most interesting flavor categories of spirit.
You hear that,
but
Mom?
Also, when used correctly, go on to make some of the world's greatest cocktails. So there you
have it. You hear that, Mom?
Gin's a spirit with a fabulous history, and now it's one that you can share. Next time you're in your bar and one of your customers orders a gin, try and drop in one of these fun facts.
Very fun. Dead ringers are very fun. Maybe I should give it another. I know. These people are such professionals. they're such aficionados at this one specific type of alcohol that it makes you want to try all of them. Like, who cared about drink? You said that vodka tasted like rubbing alcohol, right? And then this lady teaching me about vodka said, well, the reason it tastes like rubbing alcohol is because you're storing it like rubbing alcohol. You got to put it in your freezer. And then it has all these different distinct tastes. And sometimes it sits in the back of your throat. Sometimes it sits in your cheeks. Sometimes it sits up front. Made from potatoes, like all that. Oh, is Bombay Sapphire gin? Okay, I've been waiting for that one to know what kind of alcohol that is. I can't wait to be able to go into like the liquor store that I was just in and look at all this stuff and kind of know my way around it a little bit more. Because really, I can only recognize like three things, plus the giant selections of wine, obviously.
From its humble beginnings until now, how gin is made hasn't changed all that much. In this lesson, we'll be looking at what goes into this liquid that so many people love and how it's made.
Okay. Making a separate category. Ingredients. We're about to learn. What do you think it's made out of? If you don't know, what's your guess? I think I spelled ingredients wrong. Huh. There we go.
The key ingredients of any gin are pretty simple. We start with water, we add a neutral base spirit, and of course, juniper berries.
Wouldn't know that. Nope. Fabulous. Grain? Hey, Bob Reservoir. What's up?
They're not actually berries. They come from the juniper tree, but are in fact seeds. These juniper berries are key to making gin because they give it its core flavor. Juniper berries themselves are slightly piney and slightly fruity.
Okay. I know I'm gonna have to remember this. Fruity. So, if you don't like juniper berries, are you telling me these aren't berries? They're seeds. They look like berries. I get it. Very piney. I like gin and tonic, but substituting soda pop for tonic and without the gin. Yeah.
With a touch of pepperiness. They're so key in the production of gin, quite simply because gin can only be called a gin when the taste of juniper is the most predominant.
Must be. Predominant flavor. Look at that. Do you see that? Do you see this? He spells flavor with the U, just like I do. It's because he's British, but I love to see it out in the wild. I never see that. I never see that outside of Shakespeare. Flavor to legally be gin. So if you don't like the berries, you're kind of out of luck. I just got finished refurbishing an old computer mouse because it was like $150 at the time, so I'm attached. Wow, that's an expensive mouse. It must have a very nice feel. Out in the what? Yes, like America doesn't put U's in there.
Flavor in that spirit. These are the three critical.
Did you say gray as in G-R-E-A versus G-R-A-Y? Or you know what I mean. The way that I know which gray is what is because G-R-E-Y is Christian Grey from 50 Shades of Grey. And G-R-A-Y is the color.
Critical ingredients. But almost all gin brands will add different botanicals to give their gin its own independent personality. A botanical simply means something natural.
So, botanical gardens. It reminds me of that time, I think Meg and I played Sherlock Holmes. And there was a case about the botanical gardens. If few of them.
So the addition of fruits, seeds, roots, herbs, or even...
Okay. Fruit... I'm going to write this somewhere different. Fruits, roots, seeds, and herbs, I think it's it.
And spices work just perfectly.
Spices.
Some gins have as few as 3 or even 4 botanicals, but the Scottish gin botanist has up to 31 botanicals used to make it.
As few as 3 botanicals. But can be.
It's the different combination of botanicals that differentiate one gin from another. And right now there are some small boutique gins that are really focused on some of the native ingredients local to where they're producing that are defining them by their style right now. So those are all the ingredients that go into gin. Now let's look at how they're combined into the gins we know and love that sit on our back bar. Gin, of course, is made in a distillery. Our friends at Four Pillars Gin in Victoria kindly invites us behind the scenes so we get to check out how gin is made in real life. Gin is made in these giant units known as stills. To start the process, we take our neutral base spirit, ordinarily a grain-based spirit. Remember, this is something like a vodka, but it's been purified so it's unbelievably strong.
Normally, grain-based spirit. Very distilled. Very distilled. Like vodka. A vodka. They have a UN4, but it's so weird.
We add it into the pot, which is the fat part of the still. Now from here, there are a couple of ways you can make gin. The first is to add all the botanicals into the pot with a neutral spirit. Once everything's in, shut the door and turn on the heating elements. We're now going to start cooking all the botanicals by adding heat in the base spirit. That's going to bring out all the incredible flavor of each and every botanical. This is the start of distillation. As the pot boils, the vapors begin to rise up. And in some cases, those vapors might pass through what's known as a botanical basket. This is where a second lot of botanicals are being stored. As the vapor comes up and through the basket, it opens up the flavor of the botanicals and passes through along with the vapor. This is known as vapor infusion. And in some distilleries, this is the only way of extracting the flavor of botanicals. Other distilleries like Four Pillars use...
You know, I think... Well, I was about to say it's kind of like matcha, but matcha uses the whole leaf, so maybe not quite.
Use both. They'll have the flavor from boiling the botanicals in the first phase, and then they'll get a second phase of infusion from vapor infusion. So they're gonna double down for a bit of extra added punch. After passing through the botanical basket, the vapor finally arrives at the column still. That's when it condenses back again into a liquid. Each one.
what was it called? Something still? Or it turns back into a liquid.
Through the botanical basket, the vapor finally arrives at the column still. That's when it condenses back again into a liquid. Each one is like a mini distillation of its own, condensing and recondensing the spirit until it's super refined. Eventually, the extremely high proof gin will start to drip out at a whopping 94% alcohol by volume. This is, of course, way too strong to be sold. So water now must be added to bring it down to an appropriate ABV, ready to go to the shops. The gin then gets chilled down to a temperature of 2 degrees Celsius before the final stage of the process, bottling. The whole process only takes a matter of hours from start to finish. That's pretty amazing, hey? Do you know what botanicals go into making your favorite gin? If you don't, go and find out. And if you're really up for a challenge, see if you can identify the botanicals by tasting the gin alone.
There we go. Just watching that one without writing too much down, I think I retained a lot of it. Because I guess I'm a visual learner. Like, yeah, then they turn into gas and then back into liquid. No, I'm not converting. Like, yeah, if they ask me, how much do they chill it in Fahrenheit? I'm like, that's not why I'm here. I'm not here to do math conversions. I'm just here to learn about gin.
Has been produced all those hundreds of years ago, there are now multiple different styles. And of course, with every different style, there's a different way of serving that gin perfectly. The process of making these gins is mostly the same, but of course, the slightest change can create a brand new profile. In this lesson, we're going to look at the six most common varietals of gin. Genevieve, Plymouth, Navy Strength, Old Tom, New Wave, London Dry.
Okay, are you ready for this? Mom's gonna learn so much. Okay, Plymouth? How do you say that? Plymouth? I don't know. That sounds very familiar. On Plymouth Rock. Navy Strength. Oh. Well, I learned something, Mike. New Wave. It's like music. And of course, London is dry. Although it rains all the time, so.
In just a few minutes' time, you'll have a basic understanding of each of these gin styles and when's best to use every single one. The first style of gin I want to talk about is Genevieve. It's the godfather of all gins. Created by the Dutch in the 16th century, it adds a little bit of malt wine to it, sometimes only 15%. But what that does is give it this incredible, rich, full-bodied, even smoky style flavor.
Hold on.
It's definitely worth trying out. Just give it this incredible—
Oh my goodness. They really expect you to remember all this without writing it down. I guess I gotta write that this is the godfather.
Rich, full-bodied, even smoky style flavor.
And rich, full-bodied. Add smoky because they're gonna put that on that test, I swear.
It's definitely worth trying out. Our next style of gin is Plymouth. Simply put, Plymouth gin must be made in Plymouth. Now that is a small town on the southwest coast of England. In the same way that cognacs must be made in cognac, in the same way that champagne must be made in champagne,
that's
the legal defining factor in Plymouth gin is it must be made in Plymouth. The style of the gin is very basic. It's got a lovely juniper flavor to it. And although it's slightly sweet, it still has those incredible citrus notes too. My favorite style of gin from Plymouth is simply called Plymouth Gin. Get your hands on a bottle and give it a try. Thank me later. The next style of gin we'll be talking about are Navy Strength gins. Simply put, these are gins that are high in alcohol, around 57 plus. These punchy style gins come from the seas. When people were buying and trading in gins, what they would do is they would add some gunpowder to the gin. If they lit it and the gunpowder still lit, then they knew that that gin was good quality and high in alcohol. And therefore the rule of 57% there stands, but they can be much higher. Now, despite the fact that they're quite rough and quite raw, don't let that put you off. Navy gins are incredible for mixing great cocktails with. If you get the chance, I really recommend a Negroni, or if you've got the stomach for it, try a dry gin martini with Navy Strength. It really will wake you up.
A Negroni.
Speaking of cocktail gins,
what about the Air Force?
I love an Old Tom. Old Tom gin is very simply a great classic style gin, but with the addition of extra sugar. Essentially, when they made gin back in the day, it was a little bit rough and a little bit ready, and the addition of that sugar really made it settle nicely. And classic style cocktails like the Tom Collins often use and call for that style of gin. A Tom Collins, simply put, is just gin, citrus, sugar, and soda. And it's those kind of drinks that I think perfectly match an Old Tom style gin. Next up, new wave gins. Now, what is a new wave gin? Well, a really fun expression of a new wave gin might be something like the lemon drizzle gin that comes from the guys at Sipsmith. A really unusual flavor profile that they put together that's really confident in that sweet citrus style. And for me as a bartender, that means I can go ahead and create some really brand new, exciting, and contemporary drinks with these unique gin styles. The last style of gin I want to talk about is one that's very dear to me. Of course, that is the London Dry Gin. Simply put, as we've discussed before,
it's all of our botanicals
thrown inside our pot still, macerated and distilled. Big, fat, juicy juniper flavors coming through the top, supported by
Hold on. Botanicals must be added. So many words. Distillation.
Citruses and barks giving a little bit of bitterness. They're great gins and they're what we know and love for our classic style gin and tonics or our dry martinis. Well, that's all simple enough.
Okay. That's important. Now for classic gin, tonics, and dry martinis.
So to be a London Dry, we know all botanicals have to be in the distillation. If not, it becomes a compound gin. And that's why some brands can't put London Dry Gin on their labels. They've added something else into the mix outside of that one distillation. So if you want to go away and taste some London Dry Gin, try a couple of the classics. Tanqueray is a really amazing place to start. And don't miss out on Bombay Sapphire. Both do the job brilliantly, yet are very different. Go and taste them and find out the difference between the two. So just to recap, the six main styles of gin are Genevieve, Plymouth, Navy Strength, Old Tom, New Wave, London Dry. Each one is slightly different, depending on maybe the alcohol content, the flavor, perhaps where it's made, or the method by how it's put together. If there's a style of gin that you haven't tried, please go and buy yourself a bottle and give it a go.
I feel more confident about this one than the vodka one so far.
In this lesson, I'm going to give you an overview of what's going on in the world of gin today, where it's being produced, and we're going to have a little look at some of the key players in the gin market who are killing it out there. So where is gin produced? Well, in fact, gin can be produced anywhere, and it is produced everywhere. The big key players are, of course, Europe. In Holland, where it was first introduced, right the way through to the UK, where it is now absolutely massive. There are over 500 gins being produced right here in the United Kingdom. Of course, the US, they have a huge market for gin too. But across Europe, Spain, Italy, France, Portugal, you name it, we're all producing gin right now. So here in front of me are some of the biggest players in the gin market across the world. First up, we've got one of my favorites, Hendrix.
Sounds
when
like it,
Mom. This gin came to market in 1999, it really revolutionized gin itself. As we all know today, it's served with a slice of cucumber. This unusual blend of flavors has made people think differently about not only gin and how it can be produced, but also how us bartenders can serve it. Next up, Beefeater, one of my favorite gin and tonic gins. It's been produced here in the UK since 1862 when James Burrough first opened his distillery in Chelsea.
Whoa, my brain just didn't compute and said Joe Burrough. On my brain, when I was at Law and Order, the guy sitting across from me in the holding room was talking about how much he loved Joe Burrough. I was like, same. He's like, I think you have a different love for him. And I'm like, no, I have every type of love for him. Hold on, I'm not ready for Sapphire yet. Hi, Paul. Semi-dry is a pretty good sweet spot for me. Haven't had enough alcohol to know.
It's been produced here in the UK since 1862 when James Burrough first opened his distillery in Chelsea. Next up is Tanqueray, one of two gins I have here from the Diageo guys. It was produced in 1830, round the corner from where we are here in London, in Bloomsbury. It's a stunning gin and served straight up with a twist of lemon is a perfect martini every time. This iconic...
straight up.
The blue bottle on my right hand side is of course Bombay Sapphire. Created in 1987, this has an unusual way of macerating its botanicals to create the gin flavors that we know and love. It is of course using the Carter head still. Essentially what is different to the other gins in front of me is that when it's produced, the vapors from the alcohol go through essentially a cage packed full of botanicals. The flavor that comes out the other side is Bombay Sapphire. The last gin we have today, but by no means the least, is Gordon's. Created in 1769 by Alexander Gordon, this is now the biggest selling gin on the planet. It was one of the first ever legalized gins, and its success for quality and consistency has guaranteed its global domination. So what is the state of the gin market today? Well, it is absolutely booming. Gin has gone crazy. The UK is in fact the biggest export of gin around the world. Last year alone, in 2016, we sold over £470 million worth of gin to 139 different countries. That's up 12% from the year before. So it's not just us in the UK who are mad about gin. The rest of the world are just as obsessed too. So to recap, we've looked at where gin is being produced, what's going on in the global gin world right now, and some of the key players behind some of the world's biggest gin brands. If you want to take this a step further, why don't you try and find out about more gins made in your local area. Get online and see who's mixing up some beautiful gin in your hometown. Give them a call, get your hands on a bottle, and give it a try.
I am out of my drink. I need to refill it. So before I do the next one, oh, his name is JJ. How to recommend gin to customers. Okay. When I was on the Law and Order set, every single drink on the shelves of that real bar was gin. I noticed that. So I knew I had to do gin next because of that. One moment, I will be back. I'm taking my headphones with me. Wait, what's in a white Russian? I don't remember. Mom would know.
By now, you should have a really good idea of what gin is, where it comes from, and the different styles that are out there. This is great, but it's just the start. If you guys are working hospitality, and I'm guessing that you are, it's your job to guide your guests through your back bar, showing and exposing them to new products and new brands that you think they might love and enjoy, using your knowledge and understanding of not just gin, but each of the brands themselves. You're gonna have to become really confident at upselling these gins. Now, if you're the kind of person who gets freaked out by the idea of having to do this, don't worry. It's much easier than you might think. In this lesson, I'm gonna go through my top tips for making recommendations to guests. We're gonna be talking about what you need to know about these brands and when you're gonna find the opportunities to upsell with each and every guest every time.
By the way, this guy looks like the most Dutch British man I've ever seen in my life.
So, what do you really need to know? Well, of course, you have to know something about these brands. I mean, for starters, you have to understand the brand name, how to pronounce it, where does it come from, maybe a little bit of history. The more knowledge you can impart on your guests, the more comfort and confidence they're gonna have in you as a bartender. Learn about the taste profile. If you're missing one style of gin, you might have an alternative that you can recommend. When it comes to price, it's really crucial. Some gins can be incredibly expensive, some gins incredibly cheap. But don't let the price distract you. There's some cheap gins out there that are incredible, and there are some expensive gins.
In real life, that man is probably like 6'4". Yes, Dutch people are so tall. The men and the women. Like, I remember when I was dating the guy from the Netherlands. He was like, I'm just like average in my home country. And he was like 6'2".
Gins out there that might not be worth the money. Don't be so fast to judge. So what are the rules for recommending? Well, if a customer comes to the bar, take the opportunity to make some suggestions at least. If they want a gin and tonic,
Oh, hey there, Snipe. It's nice to see you. We were talking about Navy strength gins. And we're like, what about Air Force gins? You would know about it. I know, I was just noticing the gem too. It looks real snazzy. You're the only person that has that one, I think, which, special.
Ask them what kind of gin would they like. A martini, even more so.
I'm not going to write down talk to the customer. I get that part.
Find out what their favorite gins are. Perhaps there's an opportunity to recommend a similar style of gin, knowing what you know about gin styles. It might be about region. It might be another gin from a similar place. Use those opportunities to connect with your guests, to make genuine, thoughtful recommendations, ones that they will be able to relate to. When it comes to recommending and suggesting gins from my back bars, it's really very simple. Once I find out what kind of gins the customers like and get an understanding of what they want to pay, I'll recommend some things that I've tried perhaps quite recently. Customers are always very excited about new products to market.
You're talking about Navy strength gins, not gyms. So like, what would an Air Force gin be like?
And if you're excited about them, they're much easier to sell. Maybe perhaps it's a classic gin, something that you've used for years and years and years, and you trust in it, and you know it's gonna hit the spot every time. Some gin drinkers come in every time and they order the same gin every time.
Beefeater was one of the things on here.
But don't let that stop you offering.
It's a London Dry. Made in 1862 by James Burrow.
You never know the day that they might change their minds. It's a sign of a great bartender who understands his or her back bar and is openly looking to recommend and push people into new tastes and flavors every day. So that's it, guys. You've now got my top tips of how to upsell gin to your guests. Talk to your guests and find out exactly what it is what they want. Then using that information, make a genuine, informed choice. And of course, don't be scared to try something new. Now it's your turn to get out there and start talking about gin to your customers.
Not yet, I'm not done with your course.
Start by picking your favorite gin, one you're the most confident about, and start pushing it and hopefully getting more of your customers into gin. Next time you're behind the bar, try recommending a gin to one of your guests. And if you're not behind the bar anytime soon, try recommending something to one of your friends at home.
If I can convince my mom to try gin, I'll know that I won. If I can convince her this is delicious, I know I've won. I've passed that course.
Of course, if you're working behind the bar, one of the most important things is to understand how to serve gin to your customers. There are lots of different ways that you can serve gin, but in this lesson, we're gonna look at the most popular. We're gonna look at how to make the gin and tonic and discuss where this world-famous cocktail comes from. I'll also tell you where to go to mix up some of my favorite gin cocktail recipes. The gin and tonic came around in the 19th century. Essentially, we had a load of British soldiers jump over to Africa and they had a serious issue with malaria. So what did they do? They had to give medicine for it. That medicine was known as quinine, but unfortunately it tasted horrible. Really, really bitter. So the forces decide to do something simple. Add some citrus, add some sugar, and of course, add some gin. And that's how the gin and tonic came to be as we know it today. The modern gin and tonic as we know it today is of course much less crude than that. G&Ts are a really fun way of bartenders experimenting with not only different gins, but also different tonic waters.
And then trying to bring hold on. I'm laughing at my own thought. That's like taking Pepto-Bismol and adding strawberry and French vanilla and being like, now this is tequila rose and everybody loves it.
Bring those two things together with some really interesting and fun garnishes. I'm going to show you now how to make the perfect gin and tonic every time, the classic style recipe. I'm simply going to add our gin with a quality tonic water and the right amount of citrus in the right amount of ratios.
Yeah, I'm going to start with my glass. Ratios are so important.
Go in with some cubed ice. I like my gin and tonics ice cold. So you need a full glass of ice if you want to do that. Next up, our gin.
Oh, wait, no. I need measurements. Yeah. One. Standard measure. I'm sure they're going to write this again, and I'll have to, and it'll be more concise and easier, but.
Now our tonic water. Again, different people like their G&Ts in different ways. Personally, I like 2 tonic to 1 gin.
Hold on. I am writing 2 tonic to 1 gin, but I keep... Oh, it's still there. It's still there, faded. Am I delayed, by the way? I can't fully tell. But it is on... It's very delayed on my phone, so I don't know if it's delayed for you guys. Okay, here. Okay.
Now, take your lime, give it a good little squeeze, and we're going to chop this up into 4 pieces. Now, I like a whole quarter of lime squeezed into my gin and tonic. Discard, and throw a second one in there for luck. If your guest wants to add more tonic water, they can do. If they want to add more citrus, they can do. Of course, give that a quick little stir. You want to make sure that your G&T tastes as great from the top right the way through to the bottom. And that is the perfect gin and tonic.
So there you have it. Now you know the story of the gin and tonic and how to make the perfect one for yourself.
I love the way these bartenders are putting these drinks out in front. Like, there was the guy last time that was doing these little spritzes of the lemon and lime and oranges and whatever he was using. And his presentation was just so gorgeous. Like, him, like, flinging in that lemon peel at the end. Like, and this guy with a, here's your napkin. Like, I love the classiness of these bartenders. It's so fascinating.
Of course, there are plenty of other things that gin can be mixed with. One of my favorites is also ginger ale. Gin is the base for some of my favorite and the world's favorite classic cocktails. But to start with, practice by going away and making some fabulous gin and tonics.
Go away!
Sometimes it's the most simple drinks that can often be the hardest to perfect. Once you've got that right and finished this course, go and check out my other course on Tipsy, where I'll be taking you through some of my favorite classic gin cocktails of all time.
Dang. I'm finishing my second cup of this. It definitely has an effect. This is the most relaxed my heart has felt in weeks, to be honest.
And I've had two cups of this. Two
shooters. That's all it takes. I'm such an anxious human being.
Bartenders and cocktail lovers, this one is for you. In this lesson, we're going to be talking about how to take your gin to the next level and put your own fingerprint and stamp on the gins that you know and love. You'll find that most great bars are creating their own infusions as a way of adding a unique flavor to their cocktail menus. Gin is the perfect spirit for infusing with extra flavors. In this lesson, we'll go through the simple ways of infusing gin so that you're ready to go away and infuse your own. So how do you-
Hold on. I was just noticing over here. Look at these four bottles. It really looks like he's a wizard. He's like a wizard or a witch making potions over here.
Infusing gin so that you're ready to go away and infuse your own. So how do you infuse gin? Well, it's pretty simple, really. Of course, you've got to start with a gin. I really recommend a London Dry gin. The botanicals are perfectly matched already. So when you add your additional botanical, it should be really clear and easy to tell. If you don't, it might taste a bit funny. If you don't know where to start, try picking one of your favorite flavors or even looking at what's in season right now. Things I've found and love using are the likes of raspberries and other fruits like cherries. Teas work amazingly.
I spelled raspberries wrong. Any other fruit. Teas. Ooh, teas.
But also citrus peel. Adding dried lemon and orange to an existing gin makes for a really lovely botanical finish in any cocktail that you make. Remember, gin already has juniper and some other classic botanicals as well. So I recommend trying to complement these botanicals, but feel free to experiment and always have fun.
Yeah, which one is the drink that's made with cranberries? Because cran goes with anything, you know? You know how Ocean Spray does that? Maybe junipers can do that too.
To start your infusion, obviously take your gin and put it into a mixing container.
That's a lot of gin. That's a whole, oh, you're infusing. I got it. I was like, that's not a serving.
My infusion, I'm gonna be using Earl Grey tea. So for that, I'm gonna take 10 grams and add them into my gin.
Oh, I love that. This is a good infusion, I can already tell.
I'm gonna give it a quick stir before I'm gonna throw it into an infusion bottle.
You think so, Grunge? You like Earl Grey tea at all?
The more ingredients that you add to your mix, of course, the flavor will be stronger. For fruits, I recommend using between 200 and 400 grams per liter. If it's something like chilies you wanna use though, maybe one or two chilies will be plenty. Any more than that will probably turn into an infusion that you'd really rather not drink. There's no strict guideline on how long to infuse your gin for. But once it's in, it's best to shake it every couple of days and, of course, make sure you taste it. Sometimes you can over-infuse your ingredients, and that's when it starts to taste nasty. That's why it's so important that you give it a try. If you want to speed up the process, of course, feel free to heat the bottle. A trick in the bar trade often is to throw the bowl into the glass wash machine for a couple of rotations. That will really speed up the infusion process. When you guys are happy with your flavor, it's time to return your liquid back into its bottle.
I don't think you're supposed to, Anakin.
I'm gonna take,
which is fine with me,
a tea strainer, or if it's a bit finer, you might need a muslin cloth. And simply,
yay, I got one of those.
Pour your liquid out to capture all of the debris.
That's basically how I mix my matcha nowadays. That's fun. What? It must be video games where I've done infusions before, right? That's a common thing. I think Dark Souls you
Once
can do
transferred
infusions.
It back
you
into
can infuse
the bottle,
your weapons.
Now it's time to work out how you're gonna use it in your ultimate drink. It's that simple. Now I wonder, what's your first flavor combination going to be? And with that, that brings us to the end of our Gin Basics course. Thanks for joining me. There are some incredible gins out there in the world, and I really implore you to go out there and try and taste as many as you can. And of course, bring back that knowledge and love of gin back to your customers so you can share it with them every single day.
I feel so much more confident about this one. Cheers! Than I did with vodka. Vodka was a trip. Go to quiz. Here we go, guys. Are you ready for the quiz? Was my screen... No, it wasn't. I thought my screen was maybe zoomed in too far. Can you guys read this? I guess I could make it bigger. Let's see. Ah. Oh, I'm so glad I did this. Install Dark Reader. No. No, I'm not going to do that. Here we go. Question one. Botanical means a fruit or vegetable, any natural ingredient, or a famous gin. I know that it's any natural ingredient because of botanical gardens. The classic recipe for a gin and tonic is 3 parts gin to 1 part. It is 1 part gin to 2 parts tonic, I believe. 2 tonic to 1 gin. Yep. I missed some of it because I was watching stuff about Lisa Marie Presley and MJ. Yeah. A Navy strength gin must have an average base volume percentage of at least 57%. I did write that. I know that's right, but I wanted to make sure I wrote it. I mean, like, rocks are natural? Hey, grunge. Technically, everything on planet Earth is natural. I've fought about this before. I've had a big rant on stream about this before, how everything is natural on planet Earth. Even plastic is natural. People want to fight me on it, but, like, everything comes from planet Earth. So, why are things mixed on the go? Why not store it somewhere? Does the taste change with time? I'd assume so. And also, it's like, yeah, you could buy a scarf at a store, or you could knit one with yarn that you buy, with higher quality yarn that you buy or something. Is this part two? This is part two. I mean, this is the first part of tonight, which is just gin. This is the first time we're tackling gin. Not everything comes from the earth, though. Then you're talking about stuff that comes from space. And what about the stuff that comes from space is not natural? How is there stuff that isn't natural? I already know what the argument people will say is that, well, if it's made by humans. I mean, is honey natural? Honey is made by bees. Would you consider honey natural? If bees decide to infuse honey with sand and create honey 2.0, is that still natural just because they have higher developed brains? Even though bees are pretty smart. Fake eyelashes? What are fake eyelashes made of? Now I'm kind of grossed out. It's just plastic, right? Ew. It's not real hair. To check if your infusion is ready, you should look at it, taste it, serve it. A customer will let you know if it tastes okay. That seems like that would be my answer. Because I don't like the taste. I'd be like, this smells funky. Can you try this and let me know if it's good? Let's taste it and... No, not look at it. It's shake it and taste it. It's chip hair. Did we generally engineer the bees to be smarter? Yeah. Yeah, CJ. You're asking the good questions. True thinker. You should only make recommendations to new customers. No, only if you feel very not confident, which would be me again. Again, I would answer differently, but I know what the answer is. From which drink did gin evolve? Vodka, rum, kenifer, and wine. Vodka. Jennifer is just what gin is in Dutch, isn't it? Right? I was gonna mention the milk thing, Mom, but that's exactly what I was thinking about. I believe it's vodka because I wrote down, I said it out loud, I'm like, vodka. I'm double checking. Very distilled, like vodka. Please tell me it's vodka. Right? Someone, while I'm answering these next ones, make sure that I'm right on that. Thanks. Hendrick's gin is traditionally served with a slice of cucumber. What gin is made in? Barrels, stills, brewery, bathtubs. It's made in all of them. It said it could be made in anything. It used to be made in bathtubs. Lead baths, aka bathtub gin, but I think they stopped doing that. So, it's made in giant stills. But aren't stills in breweries? Am I crazy that this is kind of a trick question? Kind of rude. What are the advantages of knowing somebody that bartends? You think Jennifer is right? That feels bad, but okay, I understand. What are the advantages of knowing somebody that bartends? That they know more things about drinks. All the bartenders I know are very, what's the word I'm looking for? Charming. They're very charming people. They know how to talk to people. I mean, that's like 80% of bartending, I'd say. But they have to be. I was born to be charming, not sincere. Which of these are common styles of gin? Plymouth, Navy String, Old Tom, Dutch Courage, New Wave, London Dry, and Jennifer. I could never be one. A robot is more charming than I. Well, then you'd have to learn. See, bartenders are better at listening rather than talking. Yeah, but like they still have to be... I mean, there's still that charm to it, though, even if they're good listeners, right? Which style of gin is great for using as a base for infusions? It was London Dry. Recommended LD. Infusing gin is a great way to create your own unique flavors, easy to do, becoming more popular with bartenders, all of the above. Finally, an all of the above question. I need to learn acting. Acting isn't gonna help you. I think if you know how to act charming, you can be charming. That's kind of a weird thing to say, but maybe it makes sense. Gin can be produced anywhere. Anywhere that juniper's berries grow. Well, if it needs to have juniper berries, he said anywhere, but it needs the juniper berries. Well, I guess I can export it. So I'm going to say anywhere. I feel like that's another trick question. What are the three key... Oh, I forgot to turn on... Love these recommended videos. Near the end of the quiz, but oh, maybe I'm not. No matter what, you're always charming to me. What are the three ingredients in gin? That would be water, juniper berries, and a natural base spirit. Yep. London Dry gin must be made in London. Style, not a flavor. All botanicals must be added during the first distillery. Known for classic gin tonics and dry martinis. I thought I wrote it down, though. No, the Plymouth one has to be made in Plymouth. But London ones don't have to. It said it is made in London. I mean, that makes sense. But must it be made in London? No. The classic garnish for a gin and tonic is lime. I think that's true. He was using a lime quite a bit. Yeah, you cut the lime into four slices. That has to be it. Citrus, sugar, and gin. Yep. I have a question. I maybe have an answer. How is that angel not on fire? You must mean the border. I mean, I can light my candle right now. Let's do it. One moment. Smell like Christmas in here. I mean, do you think I'm on fire? The bartender's role is to recommend products to customers as well as serve them. Yeah. I'm gonna have a hard time at that, I think. That'll probably be the hardest thing. But if I'm a Broadway bartender, I don't think I have to know that much. Explain myself. When did gin and tonic originate? 17th, 18th, 19th, or 20th? I thought it was 16th, but... Gin and tonic was... Oh, gin and tonic is the 19th. I'm glad I wrote that down. If you're going to recommend a gin, it's good to know its name, where it comes from, the price, the style, what it tastes like, all of the above. For something to legally... to be legally called a gin, what must the predominant flavor be? Juniper. I like how it said orange again. Like, if you forgot, there's two questions that you could mess up by putting orange. The Gin Act of which year brought the gin craze into the in the UK under control? 1751. I wrote it. I know it. I know it by memory. In 1736, gin tax begins. Yeah, 1751. That's true, Anakin. You're right. Don't tell Snipe. Where can Plymouth gin be made? Plymouth! Alright. That's all of them. There's one question I'm a little scared about, but besides that... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6... I think that'll be 100%. Here we go. Submit. Cross your fingers. 3, 2, 1. Ooh. 100%. Let's go. Let's go. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Best one yet. Yeah. 100%. Yeah. It's okay. You're just a chat to me, Anakin. Let's go! Yeah, 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 Grunge. You helped me get one right. Congrats. Bum, bum, bum. Look at that. All right, now I gotta download my certificate. I still feel like I'm gonna look at all these bottles of gin and not know anything. I'm just stop this, Anakin. So, I will save image. Yes, PNG. Let's go. Oh, I also want one as a PDF, I think. I don't know. Why not? Cool. Look at that. Look at that. I got three of them so far. I just played the song. Lucky you, you got to hear the ending of it. Okay. So, This is cool. All right, now we can do whiskey. Who is a whiskey fan in chat? I'd assume that would mostly be men. They tend to like whiskey. What's gin anyway? Well, it happens to be water, natural base spirit, neutral base spirit, and juniper berries. No cheating. I knew it. This is what country songs are made of. Yeah. Oops. Whiskey basics, let's go. Oh, this is bourbon.
We're gonna do a brief little history on bourbon. Bourbon has been distilled in the United States since the early 1800s and maybe even earlier. Folks were moving away from the original colony.
Okay, he really just jumped into it. One moment. Distilled in the US since the 1800s.
And bringing stills over more into the western part of the United States.
Not aged for years the way it is today.
And they're basically using it as a way to stretch the yield of their crops and using it for barter, trade, for celebrations, for all things like weddings, cabin raisings, things of that nature. Bourbon nowadays is aged, which really kind of started after the inception of the coffee still or the continuous still that allowed for a larger production. And folks started throwing it in barrels, which is one of the things that makes bourbon what it is. Now, you might be asking yourself, what exactly is bourbon? Why?
Sorry, guys. One moment. I realize that this is not the full screen. Here we go.
How can we call it bourbon? Well, first of all, bourbon must be made in the United States. It must be comprised of at least 51% corn in the mash bill.
Did you know that? It's another corn one.
Other grains that are used are rye, wheat, and other grains that can comprise anything up to 49%. Mash bills kind of give and take and change as people come up with their own formula. It must also go into brand new American oak barrels, all of which must be charred.
Okay, he's so fast. I mean, it's great. I hope they showcase bullet bourbon. American. That's fun. But it has to be a certain type of tree because that'll change the flavor.
Charred as well. In order to be bourbon, you still must distill it to no higher than 160 proof. Goes into the barrel at no higher than 125 proof and must go in a bottle at least 80 proof.
Okay.
Outside of that, you're going to be talking about ryes and single malts and things of that nature. And what differentiates bourbon to a rye is pretty much the same parameters as bourbon, except 51% rye. And then you start talking about single malts, and you're talking about malted barley instead of corn and whatnot and as the predominant grain in the mash bill. Another thing to keep in mind about what makes bourbon is you're not allowed to add any sort of caramel colors, sweeteners, or any additives whatsoever. Now.
Okay. Additives of any kind.
Now, today, there are varying different types of production methodology, which we'll get into, but to be bourbon, you must follow all of that criteria. Some bourbon terminology you want to keep in mind as well, if you look on some labels, you notice that there are words like straight or bonded. What that essentially means, in order to be straight, you must be aging in new American oak barrels for a minimum of 2 years, and to be bonded, it's a few more parameters there. You have to bottle it at 100 proof, and you must...
I don't know what proof means. Federally bonded warehouses.
Must be aging in barrels for a minimum of 4 years in federally bonded warehouses. It must be distilled in one distilling season at one distillery, and all of these parameters as far as being bonded must be labeled as well. All bourbon is whiskey, but not all whiskey is bourbon.
Okay. All bourbon is whiskey. Not all whiskey's bourbon. Underline. Star.
Whiskey is basically the family of that particular type of spirit. So rye, scotch, Japanese whiskey, bourbon are all whiskeys, but like I said, not all whiskeys are in fact bourbon. There's a common misconception with bourbon that bourbon must be made in, you know, Bourbon County or in Kentucky. That's just not true. If we look back at the parameters, none of which state that it needs to be made in Bourbon County or Kentucky as a whole. In fact, bourbon is made not a block away from my bar here in Seattle. So definitely something to keep in mind of. But hopefully you have a better, more clear understanding of what makes bourbon, a little history behind it, and debunked a couple of myths as well.
Okay. The rise of bourbon in American cocktail culture.
All right, now what we're going to talk about here is basically bourbon's effect.
Hold up. Is this still not right? No, it is. Oh my god. Oh!
Effect on American cocktail culture, modern cocktail culture, and basically how it came to be here in the United States. In terms of how and where bourbon came from and the knowledge and like who knew about this stuff and who really started doing it, a lot of it had to do with a lot of the immigrants coming over from Europe, more namely Ireland and Scotland, and folks that were coming over here and starting their own grain-based farms. So with all the extra wheat and malted barley and corn more specifically, you know, these guys needed to find ways to stretch the yield of their crops for trade, celebration, and so forth. We want to talk about how that became so prevalent in American cocktail history. You look at the classics, you look at Old Fashions, Manhattan, Sazeracs, most of which were using rye at first, which was very, very accessible, and from what I've been made to understand, the Irish are really, really
kind
into
of
it.
Grunge.
But what ended up changing it in terms of the American palate is corn. Corn is much sweeter versus the spicier rye flavors you get from those grains, and I think that a lot of folks switched over from rye into bourbon because A, corn was being mass produced in a big way, and it was sweeter, therefore more approachable and palpable for most folks at bars. And we see that a lot of that today as well. The American palate is still very sweet. It kind of shies away from really bold flavor profiles, spiciness, bitterness, umami, things like that. So when we look at
traditional cocktails, I hate the word umami because it's like savory, right? But it has a word that kind of sounds like kawaii, so it should be sweet, but it's not.
Which is your Manhattans, your Sazeracs, and whatnot. They've switched from their original base spirits from rye or cognac by way of the Sazerac over into bourbon, and you know bourbon took a bit of a.
I just want you to know that. My webcam is on fire. It is burning up. That's so weird. My other webcam never heated up at all. It wasn't even capable of producing heat, but wow. This This is like an iPod. Okay. That's cool. Your skin general is doing so much. Yeah.
Lol. In popularity, I mean, basically after Prohibition, bourbon production completely shut down, and after the end of Prohibition...
Right. None of these have talked about Prohibition yet.
It really, really hit this huge lull. And folks started drinking a lot more clear distillates, your gins, your vodkas and whatnot. And that kind of continued up past the 70s and whatnot, and the, as it's known as the dead era of cocktails in the 70s and 80s. And we saw them really coming back here in more modern times, the cocktail renaissance, or another wave of popular cocktail culture here in the 2000s and even till today. People are really getting back into
I don't know what its toast means. Like, that doesn't mean that it's broken. It just means that it has to cool down a little bit first.
Bourbon, and not just by way of cocktails, but also single spirit drinking. People are sipping and drinking whiskey and bourbon on its own, be it neat or on the rocks. And that's something that you really didn't see too much back even 30 years ago. So it's really impressive to see how the cultural viewpoint of whiskey has changed from its inception here in the States in the 1830s to the rise and fall of Prohibition to modern drinking culture. It's changed just sporadically throughout time and in a big way. And it's changed the way that we look at, create, and make cocktails today.
After I do all these sessions, I do kind of want you everybody to message me telling me their favorite alcohol recommendations, because there's so much that I haven't tried that, you know, including what Paul said. Okay, well, I don't know the difference.
Making whiskey is quite a complex process, and the way it comes from the raw material of the grain and into our glass is would be best explained by Matt.
Yeah, sure. So we've got our malted barley here. We make single malt whiskey at Westland. So single malt means two things fundamentally. One, it's made at one distillery. That's a single part. Two, it's made from nothing but malted barley. So malted barley is just basically sprouted barley. You take raw barley. Actually, we don't do any of this. Most distilleries don't do any of this. Take the raw barley that comes from the farmers, goes to a malting plant. They're going to soak it in water for a few days and basically tricks the grain into growing. So it's going to grow for 3 or 4 days. A lot of things are going to happen inside the grain. You're going to develop some enzymes to help convert that starch into sugar later on in the process. And then it's stopped. So the traditional way of stopping it is to burn peat as fuel around it, which will dry the grain out. It's kind of like barbecuing food. So you get that smoky flavor, but really what you're trying to do is cook it. You're trying to dry it out. So at the end of the process, you've got something that looks like this. This is what we call pale malt, typically used in Scotland.
Oh,
so
weird.
We've also got a number of other grains that we have here. They're all malted barley.
Now we have a brief understanding of the grains themselves. Where do we go from here?
So now we got to take these grains. We're going to crack the grains. We'll make something called grist here. So it's a little bit different from, say, bourbon production. Bourbon production, they're going to really kind of finely ground the grains. We just want to crack the grain. Barley has a husk, and we want to keep that husk intact for the mashing process.
Hey, hello, what's this? Oh, that's just on the video. What?
Process over here. So we put it through what we call a four-roller mill, crack
what's
the grain,
there?
And then
huh?
All that goes over to the mash house.
You okay, bud?
Take a look at that, huh?
Yeah, let's do it. So this is our mashing system. So what we're going to do here is we're going to take our malted barley that we've milled up. We call this grist. That's going to go in here with warm water. We're going to try to achieve a temperature of 64 degrees Celsius, about 145, 147 degrees Fahrenheit. That temperature is where the enzymes in the grain that were developed during the malting process are going to convert the starch into sugar. When we ferment things, yeast is going to take that sugar and convert it into alcohol, but in grains, all grains, whether it's being used to make bourbon or whether it's being used to make beer, all that stuff needs to be converted from starch into sugar first. So these enzymes are cutting up starch, producing sugar compounds. This takes about half an hour in here. So we're mixing it up right now. And then with these rakes going, we'll...
It's still my dream to work in one of these factories for a day. Or actually not a day, a week. I've always wanted to work in a factory like this for a week. And I don't mean just whiskey. I mean anything like this. You know the show Unwrapped? I used to play some episodes of Unwrapped on stream. Like Esther Price or... I mean any of these. How like commercialized food is made. I just really want to do those jobs where there's those conveyor belts and stuff. But only a week. I don't think, I think after that I would not like it anymore.
We'll stop them and then we'll let the liquid drain out.
Very cool. We have some pretty sizable fermentation tanks. What's going on in here?
So this is fermentation. This is the key to all alcoholic beverages, is taking the yeast that we're going to put in here and use that to convert the sugar into ethanol, into alcohol that we all know and love. So the way that we do that, we've extracted the sugar along with the water from the mash and the flavor compounds. We've got all that in there. You can also see the color in here. You can see how dark this is. Some of the darker roasted malts, some of that color is coming through.
So after 5 days, would you say like that's kind of par for the course for fermentation in regards to single malts, and how does that...
Yeah, they're kind of wearing the same shirt.
Compared to bourbon, would you say?
Yeah, 5 days is actually pretty long for a single malt fermentation. I would say the industry standard in Scotland is probably about 2.5 days, so, you know, 40, 50, 60 hours, something like that.
Sorry, I just can't help to notice, but these two are the same man if they were in a video game in, like, Grand Theft Auto and was like, change your hairstyle. Anyway.
So where do we go from here? Now we have fermented product. What happens next?
Now we have fermented product. So now we're going to take this and we're going to send it to the still room.
What do we got going on here?
So we have a relatively standard double distillation process here. There's a couple of minor hitches here that make it a little bit different from some of the Scottish distilleries. But for the most part, this is much more Scottish in technique relative to what we'd call typical American style. So these two stills are both built by Vendome Copper and Brass in Louisville, Kentucky. They look complicated. People come in here and say, you know, this looks like a submarine or something like that. But, you know, pod distillation, the way that we practice it here, this has been around for God knows how long, 1,000 years, maybe more. So what double distillation does is it retains flavor. A lot of people think you want more distillations. It kind of depends on what you're looking for. Vodka, of course, is distilled many, many times.
Right.
But if you want to retain flavor, you want to distill it just like twice. Mm. This is basically as few times as you could possibly distill something. So when we do this, we're going to separate out the distillate, the liquid that comes out of the still, into three primary fractions. So the first stuff that comes off, there's some ethanol, of course, but you're also going to get these compounds that collectively smell solventy and like glue. So these are compounds like ethyl acetate, which would be like nail polish remover, acetaldehyde, which all have low boiling points. So they will boil off first. We don't want those in our whiskey, so we put those into its own tank. But after a while, we're going to be here smelling, and all of the determination of what goes...
Are you telling me that this place kind of smells like nail polish remover? Because that sounds awful.
Into our whiskey, the one fraction that we keep, all that is done by nose alone.
Wow.
So it's not done by time or temperature. We have those as guideposts, but the final judgment is done by nose alone. So what we're looking for here is fruitiness. And that fruitiness has to be a very, very particular type of fruitiness. The way that I describe it is we get these beautiful red fruit notes that come from fermentation. That fruitiness, when it goes from kind of artificial, almost like fruit punch fruitiness, that's still a little bit too artificial. We keep that in what we call that heads fraction. When it gets to natural fruitiness, natural fruit juice, like maybe a pomegranate juice, that's where it's okay. So at that point, we do something called a cut. The reason why we use these pot stills is because almost they are bad at distilling. And because they're bad at distilling, more character is retained.
All right, so now we've selected our grains, we've milled, we've fermented, we've distilled. Now on to barrel aging. What happens here?
So maturation is very, very important in whiskey making, and it's also really, really misunderstood. Mm-hmm. So one of the fundamental things we have here is we've got this we call new make spirit. So when it comes off the still, We've got some of the grain flavors, some of the fruitiness from the fermentation. It's totally clear, totally colorless. All the color is coming from the cask. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna put it into a cask. Now there's a lot of options. The type of cask, of course, varies depending upon what style of whiskey you're making. But the other big thing for us is our local oak species, and that's Gary oak. That only grows here in the Pacific Northwest. That's kind of basically Vancouver, BC, Seattle, and Portland. It's actually so rare that you can't cut it down. So really? We can only get the wood when it comes down naturally. And even then it has to be air dried for 3 years.
What?
We're one of the first distilleries to use it. The flavor is just unbelievable. But more than it being unbelievable is it's our oak. You know, this is our oak species. When we look at making a whiskey that really has that sense of place, using that oak is imperative for us because it is our oak species.
It sounds like basically every step of the way from grain to glass, there's some sort of local element to it.
Absolutely. We think that, again, in making whiskey as authentically as possible and making a compelling whiskey, you know, let's not copy Scotland. You know, Scotland does a lot of good things, but just aspiring to copy them, I think, is almost a little bit sad, you know, in a way.
Right.
Let's try to make a whiskey that has that real sense of place.
Made in America. Click analyze to begin. Comment, analyze, much, must match, per RAM button.
Something that can't be imitated anywhere else.
Who didn't get the rights to this stock footage?
Not just a local product for the sake of being local. This is important. Not local for the sake of being local, but local because it's better. You know what I mean? Like, that's the key thing. And this is, to me, the most exciting thing in spirits and in whiskey in particular, is once everybody starts pursuing that globally, we will see so much new and exciting things out there for decades.
Yeah, it sounds like you're really spearheading things in terms of that, and I think that's truly unique. It's incredible.
Absolutely. Yeah, we're trying. We're working hard. It takes a long time. Can't rush the whiskey, but trying hard.
Very cool. Thank you so much for walking us through the process. Wonderful, wonderful whiskey, and you know, I think definitely learned a lot from this. This is wonderful.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Cheers.
Cheers.
I'm more nervous about this quiz, personally. So, like, I told Mom that I was going to start this at 5 p.m. because I knew I was going to get really tired really quickly because yesterday's work on Law & Order made me exhausted. So my eyes are like, I'm awake, but my eyes are kind of doing that thing where it's, like, blinking all the time. They feel dry. Just want to lay down, but I gotta get through this. I gotta get through the whiskey part. We're only that far through. Okay, let's go. This video is only 3 minutes.
We're here at Westland Distillery in Seattle, Washington, and we're gonna talk about the influence of wood on whiskey. And when we're talking about barrels more specifically, you know, we use a bunch of different types of barrels, everything from ex-bourbon casks, new American oak, and various types of sherry casks, so on and so forth. And when we're talking about what wood does to whiskey.
Well, these weren't 2 servings of tequila rose because I mixed it with milk, so it's not very much. It feels like just enough. Oh no, am I gonna be wanting to drink this before bed? Is this what I've needed in order to fall asleep? Because sometimes my insomnia is just crazy. Oh no. Becoming an alcoholic, JK. This doesn't even equate to 1 serving of the drink. Bailey's, Jameson, butterscotch, schnapps, and cream. Whoa, what? Irish root beer, you're saying? Yo, that sounds like my kind of thing.
We're looking at a lot of different variables here. Here we're looking at oak, and why oak? We'll talk about that real quick. Oak is considered a pure wood, meaning that it doesn't possess these resins that would give a lot of bitterness and kind of more sulfur notes and whatnot. And it also helps extract some of those impurities in the whiskey itself. It also rounds things out, makes it a bit more palpable because whiskey off the still is very, very high proof and it still has some of those flavors that really need to be smooth and rounded out. The reason why they char the barrels here is it basically determines how much influence the wood will have on the whiskey itself. Now, when we think about barrels, it's a porous material and it's a living, breathing thing. So the
but it's not living and breathing once you cut it down, right?
The
The whiskey is actually breathed in and then extract some of the flavor from the wood and then pushed back out into the barrel. And over time, that'll change in color. As you'll see here with some of these whiskeys and all these different barrels, there's variance in color. And it'll give off different sort of vanillins and caramel flavors as well from the wood. Now, when we move over here to using ex-sherry hogsheads and the ex-sherry butts, they will influence the whiskey in a very different way. Now, these barrels are older, some of which are 80 plus years old. Now, when you use a barrel, the more you use it, the less influence the wood has on the whiskey itself, and it'll take a much longer time for that influence to occur. Now, here with the ex-sherry hogshead, we're talking about Oloroso sherry casks, which is very traditional for single malt whiskey production. You see a lot of these casks, mostly are Oloroso, so it has kind of a dry, nutty flavor to it, and adds that to the whiskey itself over time. We start moving over here to the ex-sherry butt, and this is typically Pedro Jimenez sherry casks. So it'll add a bit of sweetness and much more round, deep undertones to the whiskey, and that'll oftentimes take 12, 15 plus years to see that sort of influence here. And as we move on down here, we see rows and rows and rows of new American oak. And that's what you see in bourbon production. All bourbon needs to be aged in brand new American oak, and it influences a lot of flavors. So you see a lot of bourbons, they're typically only aged from 2 for a straight and 4 for bonded, so on and so forth. And it really influences the whiskey very, very quickly.
Isn't that fun that you could be someone who makes white oak barrels for bourbon, and that's your job? Like, that's kind of cool. I've always liked those jobs where you just make one thing for food production. Like, what was it? I think it was olive oil. I was watching this video about this traditional Japanese olive oil where it runs in the family. They've had this business for hundreds of years, but it's such a cool process. 100-year-old barrels to make this olive oil.
And after that's all said and done, they typically sell off a lot of these barrels to, say, scotch production. It's a very, very complex.
Ooh. I don't know much about scotch yet, but I think so, Grunge. I mean, maybe.
Complicated process. There's an immense amount of variables when it comes to barrel aging, and we're barely scraping the surface here. But that's basically where you see a lot of the color change and a lot of the complexity and roundness you see come out of whiskey in general.
Yay, Paul. Let's go. Okay, here we go. The most popular whiskey brands. This is where I have to really pay attention, right?
All right, now we're gonna talk about the variances in some of the bigger brands, the bigger distillers, and some of the more smaller guys, more craft distilleries, and how that's kind of changed over time. For the longest time, bourbon was made predominantly by really four guys, four different distillers, four different distilleries, and they really just made most of the brands that everyone kind of knows and loves nowadays. I mean, from your Jim Beam, your Jack Daniels, Heaven Hill, Buffalo Trace, or formerly Sazerac, these guys were pumping out all the whiskeys and all the bourbons that we all know and love today. And nowadays, you have a much bigger breadth of work from small distilleries to the large distilleries alike. Smaller guys like Heaven Hill Distillery, you have people like Willett, so on and so forth, and even local distilleries here in Seattle, such as Ula, Woodinville, Copperworks, Westland, all making different types of whiskeys. And
hold on, is he going to talk about these ones individually? He might not.
What's really cool about them is, with the big guys, there's nothing wrong with being a big brand. You get a consistently made product. It's going to taste pretty much the same most of the time when you drink it. Now, they might change, you know, the different age range and how long they keep it in the bourbon casks and whatnot, but ultimately it's going to be a pretty consistent product. And what's really unique too is, despite the fact that there's dozens upon dozens upon dozens of bourbon brands out there, and not necessarily everyone's making their own juice. Oftentimes, people will subcontract other distilleries to make the juice, they'll then buy it off them and barrel age it themselves, bottle it themselves, and slap a new label on it. And there's nothing really wrong with that. It just gives them more creative control over what they want to do with their own brand. Now, you look at folks nowadays, like you have old Bardstown, basically made at Willett, which was previously under contract with KBD, Kentucky Bourbon Distillers, was one of the largest.
Okay, now they're kind of writing stuff down. okay. I'm gonna try my best. Remember this for me, people, because I just have a feeling this one, I'm gonna be stumped a lot. Oh, my pen's running out of ink. Come on, you're my best pen. Come on. Stay with me. Stay with me. Come on. There's no way you're out of ink. You're my special left-handed pen. Come on. Oh, there we go. Wild Turkey is also a brand you'll see a lot.
Manufacturers of whiskey in the business. And we're seeing a lot of things shift. We're seeing a lot of people kind of gravitate more towards craft whiskeys. They want to taste something new and unique and local. And you have people that will always buy the tried and true brands. Like I said before, there's nothing wrong with being a larger distillery or an older business. Chances are you've been making a tried and true product. And that is, for the most part, typically unwavering. But there's definitely merit.
So I'm hearing that whiskey and bourbon is not a gatekeeping type of alcohol.
And art and everything from the spectrum of the big producers.
Almost like the great melting pot of the alcohols.
All the way to the more crafty guys. So what's awesome about the bigger brands is oftentimes they're a bit more affordable and approachable in terms of price. Therefore, easier to implement into a cocktail without having to throw in a $30 glass of whiskey into a cocktail. I personally love drinking both Beam and Buffalo Trace products, both on their own, because I think they work well as a sipper, but they also make one hell of a drink, be it a shaken or stirred cocktail. It doesn't really matter. The better product you use, the better your drink's going to taste. So if you're looking to have a bit more of a difference in your selection behind the bar and what you can use in cocktails to make it a bit more approachable, I would definitely reach for something more like the Beam Bonded or even the Beam White Label. Is really, really affordable and easily approachable and still stands strong in a cocktail. If you really kind of want to elevate it a little bit and have something a bit more complex, a bit more refined, I really enjoy Buffalo Trace. It's great as a sipper, superb in cocktails, but sometimes might be a bit out of that budgeting range for your cocktails. And same thing with Elijah Craig, wonderful sipper. Makes a really mean Manhattan. I highly recommend it. But I mean, if we're talking about budgeting behind the bar, it really comes down to affordability. And when we're talking about things like that, it's best to go with some of those
Hello,
more
Clover
tried
Smoker.
And true brands. I know that.
How are you doing?
More specifically, the Willett Pot Still, still on the higher end of things, makes great drinks. But if you're looking for your Wells, like just the more lower, cheaper end of things, reach for Old Bardstown. Some of the more Heaven Hill brands make some really wonderful stuff. But I find myself using Jim Beam. It's affordable, it tastes great, and especially with the bonded, it has a really, really nice complexity to it.
This guy's way of teaching is not good for a classroom, but very good if you're, say, doing a tour with him at his store. Like, he's got a very field trip type of teacher. He's not like a write it down on a whiteboard guy. He's a I'm taking you there. We're exploring this. I just fell in love with you.
So whiskey is made.
You can barely see me. I'm so tiny in this little box, but thank you. Nice to meet you. Gosh, I'm getting really tired. Forgive me. I was just thinking that. Ah, yay. Thank you for following. How are you doing tonight? We're getting through whiskey and bourbon. Oh, you're thinking about the teaching thing. Yeah, Grunge. I'm gonna need your help when we get to this quiz. Cool. Bam. All right, three more sections to go. Understanding different types of whiskey.
All over the world, in fact. You find folks making mostly single malts, but they're also making different types of whiskey as well. The Irish are making whiskey, the Japanese are making whiskey, the Scots, of course. But even as the far reaches of, I've seen stuff coming out of Australia, New Zealand, Taiwan. I mean, it's whiskey's being made anywhere that people can get grain, ferment it,
definitely,
distill it, and barrel it.
Like, he mentioned that one thing about the vodka and how it's distilled several times. And I was like, yeah, I do know that. And he moved on. You're totally right.
And all these different areas that are making whiskey taste completely different. We can start talking about terroir or the surrounding areas and how that impacts flavor. We can talk about a multitude of different variables. But at the end of the day, it's basically everyone's own take on how they think whiskey is made and how...
Sorry. Look at this bar. It's got that $20 burger vibe to it. You know what I mean? It's got all this copper and it's probably got those... Oh, what's the type of glass called that you make a Moscow Mule in? Mom has them. Anyway, you know what I'm talking about. And that plus the forearm tattoos, everything about, this is a stereotype of something right now. This whole picture.
Oh, it's supposed to taste of them. And you'll find that,
regionally,
there's always going to be similarities. You have your single malt scotches, and those can vary even in that own region, from the peaty scotches off the Isle of Islay to the Highland or Lowland scotches. Then you start talking about Japanese whiskey, and that's basically the Japanese take on Scottish malts. But their malts tend to be a bit more nuanced, a bit more subtle and clean in a way, whereas Scottish malts are a bit more bold and robust. And then you have the Irish whiskeys that oftentimes lean more towards almost like rye in a way, but somehow yet sweeter. Depending on the region of which we speak of and the way these whiskeys are made, it's completely different. And that's one of the best parts about the whiskey world is depending on where the region of which the origin of these whiskeys are, they're completely different. So I picked these three here because they really exemplify.
Five Guys is such a shame that they have very, very good burgers, but it's just a little bit overpriced.
The variances in regionality. So we're talking about, you know, we have the Balvenie here, and it's basically a Speyside malt in the Highlands of Scotland, and I really like...
Is this important? Scots spell whiskey with no E. Oh, I spelled Scots with two T's. My bad. That can't be misspelling when this is the note. Well, I spell Scots with two T's. I spell with one L.
I love these guys because, in my opinion, the Balvenie is the quintessential Speyside malt. But what makes them unique is that they're basically the pioneers in cask finishing, using different types of casks
to impart different
styles of flavor. In this case, you have the 21...
Just kidding. I'm pretty sure Scandinavian is, like, kind of Scottish, right?
Near Portwood, they used old port casks to get some really round, rich, fruity textures out of their whiskey.
A lot of
And then you
stuff.
Move over to the Suntory Hakushu, and it's their most bold single malt offering from all three of their distilleries between the Yamazaki, Cheetah, and Hakushu distilleries.
I'm not writing this.
Love their stuff. It's a bit more subtle and a bit lighter than something as bold as the Balvenie, but it's beautiful in its own right. And then you have Redbreast, which is basically their single pot still distillate, and it's very robust and it's very hearty. It's a lot more body to it than a lot of other Irish whiskies. And all three of these whiskies exemplify some very similar production methodologies, but are so monumentally different and unique in their own. And for me, that's what really shows the differences in whiskey and why we choose to drink the way we do. It could be American bourbon, Scottish malts, Japanese malts, or heading over to Irish whiskeys. There's something to be appreciated in each and every one of these. So in terms of trying to expand your whiskey repertoire on the back bar, it's best to kind of cover your bases. Have a few different Irish whiskeys, some Japanese, some Scotch. I find that it's always best to have a number of different Scotches, mostly because Scotch drinkers are usually quite particular about what they want to drink. They want something peated and they want something more briny. Cool, let's give them something from Islay. They want something a bit more bold and robust and more flavorful and complex, let's go with a Speyside malt, let's go with Balvenie. It's really important to kind of cover all these bases behind your bar, so that way you have something to meet anyone and everyone's needs.
Hey, hello. Pizza! How are you doing? Half a year? Yo! How have you been, darling? We're learning about whiskey right now, which also involves bourbon and scotch. So I'm kind of confused. We're going to take a quiz after two more videos. So if you know anything about whiskey, bourbon or scotch, feel free to help me because I'm trying to get a certificate. Yeah, it's good to see you. Play now. Hello? Hello? What's up? You good? Okay, well, while that's broken, I'm gonna update something real quick. I know very little about whiskey or bourbon, but I know it doesn't like me much. Do you have a favorite type of alcohol? I don't really drink alcohol much at all, but I want to learn how to be a bartender, so we're doing this. I drink vodka as my safe drink. That seems surprising to me. Jeez. Let's not do that. Well, that woke me up a little bit. Bourbon notoriously gets me ill. Oh no, it says you've earned a whiskey credit at the top. Yeah, every video I watch gets me a credit. Like, if I were to leave this whole thing right now, it would remember that I got this far. I don't know why it's broken. Hello? What did I do? Sake basics. Is that an alcoholic drink? Because that might be another one we'll have to do. Classic whiskey cocktails is free? Let's go. We're definitely going to do that at some point. Most popular. Oh, wait. Yeah, that's a whole course. Sake Japanese made from rice. Oh, I love that. Rice wine. Ooh, I want to try that. I have a feeling I'd really like it. Okay, can we, I guess, go back? Is my internet just... I'm live. The website... What is going on? Okay. Let me try opening a new tab, I guess. Okay, that works. What's up? Did the website crash? Can I go to YouTube? Yes. Can I go to just the base website? Yes, I can.
So whiskey is made all over the world, in fact. You find folks making mostly single malts, but they're also making different types of whiskey as well. The Irish are making whiskey, the Japanese are making whiskey, the Scots, of course. It's really important to kind of cover all these bases behind your bar, so that way you have something to meet anyone and everyone's needs.
Pulpy OJ versus not. But like rice makes me kind of, I love rice milk, and I love every type of rice, basically. So, okay.
Let's talk glassware. When making cocktails or serving spirits neat, it's important to use appropriate glassware.
Yeah.
Not just for aesthetics, but also for functionality. And what I'd like to talk about now is, as we go down this row here, we'll go from basically cocktail glasses down to drinking spirits neat.
I like
so
this.
So first here we have the highball or Collins glass.
Okay, hold on. I'm writing this part down. Highball glass. I wonder if I can draw these. AKA Collins glass. That's just a standard looking.
This is quintessential for any bar. You're gonna serve mixed drinks, something with a soda and a base spirit. Chances are it's probably gonna go into a highball glass, as we've seen in with the Japanese highball. Here, for proper cocktails, you'll see variations of these types of glasses. With the stemware here, we have the Nicanor glass.
Okay, hold on. Did you know that these names, mother? You got this, Shari, I'll make a great bartender. Thanks. I feel like this information I'm learning right now is not what really matters for the type of bartending that I want to do. It's more about, can I pour the cocktails? But I could surprise all my coworkers with, yeah, this one's called the Nick and Nora glass. Okay, can I draw this? Not a good time for my pen to stop working. Okay.
And the coupe.
Okay. The coupe glass. I did this one wrong. Yep, sure did. All actors bartend, it's a rite of passage. Yeah, well, what I say is all actors in LA, waitress, or they're waiters or waitresses, and all the actors in New York bartend. I'll go up to the bar knowing what they already want. Yeah, I hope so.
Both of which are great for more spiritful.
People at Broadway aren't going to go up and want to chat and be like, tell me about your favorite drink. No, first of all, there's going to be a giant line. And second of all, they got a very limited time between opening and intermission to get a drink. Very limited amount of time. Very limited. You have to use your time so wisely when you're in there. It's like for example, the Majestic Theater where Phantom of the Opera is. Super classy looking lobby and bar area, but you only get to enjoy it for a tiny span of time. It's like you're sort of paying for the space, and it's, you don't get to see it very much. Yeah, tell me the history about this drink.
Forward or stirred cocktails, but more specifically the coupe. I really enjoy using the coupe for sours with egg white because you get to see the layering perfectly.
Egg white? Dude, look at how beautiful that looks. That looks delicious. I don't know what it tastes like, but it looks like it would be delicious. Looks expensive because you know how expensive eggs are right now.
It spreads out, and the functionality of these glasses allow you to really capture some of the aromatics in a big way. We start moving over to the double rocks glass.
How do you think I'm going to draw this one? Double rocks glass. I see mom's white Russian glass right next to that one. I kind of want to call it mom's white Russian. Okay. Bam, 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 bam. With a bunch of like it looks like Elsa hit it with her powers. There we go. Perfect. Incidentally, for fun, there's a guy on YouTube who does with some history, cooking and drinking. Never knew existed. Give me a link, and I'll look it up at some point.
Here, and this is great for drinking a spirit neat or for a cocktail. If you really enjoy your spirits over the rocks or a single rock, this is perfect for that. But also, it's great for just your average mixed drinks or cocktails as well. We move into the single rocks here, and this is essentially made for single spirit drinking.
So, is that what mom makes? Hold on. Drawing. Late in college, I had a fancy glass like the one on the far left.
drinking neat or just on a couple of rocks, perfect way to go. And then if we're going to talk about drinking spirits on their own.
That's a crazy looking glass that you had. Single rock. Woo!
In my humble opinion, there's no better glass to use than the Glencairn glass. This is made for all elements of
That's the coolest name. That is so sophisticated. It looks really weird to me. I don't like the look of it, but I do love the name of it. The Glencairn glass? It's for smelling. Okay.
Tasting. Basically giving the opportunity for the aromatics to come out and really get a good solid nose on what's going on in the glass there. But it also gives the user an ability to swirl in the glass, really open up the bouquet of the aromatics. The spirits will essentially open up much easier in this kind of glass, by smell and by taste. I use this glass exclusively when I'm tasting spirits and taking notes and trying to learn more about what I'm drinking in my glass. And as we go back and forth, the functionality changes between the glasses from single spirit drinking all the way to cocktails. I believe all bars should be equipped with some variant of each and every one of these glasses, as they all kind of have a different look, different functionality.
If I do the Broadway bartending, I don't need to use any of these. You just use like a plastic cup. You like you have the cups that are movie theater style with the production on it. Like I have two Beetlejuice cups in my cabinet right now.
And essentially they're quintessential items to have in the bar.
Gotta turn a page. How to talk about whiskey flavor. Smoky, spicy, sweet. Grainy, bitter.
Hi, we're here to talk about tasting whiskey, and we have a special guest here. We have
look at that! Look, they got all the Glencairn glasses.
We have Matt Hoffman from Westland Distillery here in Seattle, Washington.
My twin.
Thanks for joining us, Matt.
Happy to do so.
Yeah, so we have some lovely items here to taste this morning. What do we got?
We got three whiskeys here. Two whiskeys from our core range. We've got our American Oak. That's kind of our flagship whiskey here. We've got our peated, which is the most traditional style of whiskey that we make here. And we've got a really cool new concept that we're just launching here now, which is the idea of a winter seasonal. So a whiskey that's specifically designed to be drank in winter has these kind of notes that are evocative of winter.
Okay, very cool. So when we talk about tasting whiskey, and we have quite a lineup here, we have it looks like a peated whiskey, some winter flavors, and it looks like your flagship. What's the proper way to start?
The proper way to start, first of all, I would say is make sure that you don't take yourself too seriously. You know, it's easy to get over the top with it and just make sure that you're having fun. The second big thing, though, is to make sure that you're not tasting it like wine. I think a lot of people, when they taste whiskey, are coming into it from an angle from wine where they're sticking their nose deep in the glass,
right,
which is like rule number one. Don't don't do that.
Right.
So the first thing that we do, we'll just go ahead and
do you think if you do that with whiskey, it's just like smelling a ton of nail polish remover?
Pour some whiskeys here right now. So this is our American Oak expression.
Okay.
First thing that we always say is find the place where you're comfortable smelling it. Is it out here smelling it? Yeah, for me, it's about right here.
About an inch away from the glass.
About an inch away from the glass. That's proper amount. And I'm not sniffing, I'm not taking a deep breath. I'm just kind of letting it come in naturally.
Is it appropriate to kind of part your lips since it's a higher alcohol content? It makes it easier to taste without, you know, blowing your palate
out?
Yeah,
that's the other big thing is you're working on a couple of, you're working with higher alcohol contents, and you want to move the air in and around your nose and your mouth, actually. So with your mouth a little bit open, I always breathe in with my nose, but I have my mouth open a little bit.
Okay. You guys are all gonna look so weird at the bar next time you go. Yeah, okay, grunge. Mm-hmm. We sneak up to the glass like a hunter.
Helps to keep the air moving around.
You're not right. I don't think so, Mom. Only if you're a snake.
So what are we getting here? What do you get as far as aromatics?
Well, the big thing for me, first of all, is this really nice malty note. So we make single malt whiskey here. Right. And with our flagship whiskey, we really want to focus on the flavors of malted barley. So we're getting a lot of kind of nutty, chocolatey, pastry-like notes.
This is up my alley. Pastry.
Almost like a freshly made ice cream cone, like a freshly made waffle cone.
Whoa, hold on. I wish I had it here to smell it. Yeah, notes is how vodka was being described too. Smells like whiskey.
Totally.
Some chocolate. We also get some really nice fruity notes. We ferment with a very fruity yeast here, so we get some nice like orange peel and cherry. And then this is matured in mostly new American oak casks, hence the name American oak. So we're getting the kind of caramel note that's classic from American oak, kind of rounds it out.
Gotcha. Okay. That's delicious.
Thank you.
So I noticed that you, when you were tasting, you were kind of taking in a bit of air. What's the purpose of that?
Yeah, I think one of the things that people tend to...
This is where I choke and die, because if he's implying that I almost breathe in when I'm taking a sip... I already struggle with drinking water, so this seems like a real problem.
I forget is when you taste, you've only got...
Am I able to describe matcha in this way? No. There's no smelling part involved with matcha, as far as I'm aware.
You know, you're really five tastes, right? You got sweet, sour, salty, bitter, umami. Mm. So when you're tasting things, when you taste chocolate, you're actually tasting it, you're smelling it back through the back of your mouth. It's something called retronasal aroma.
Retronasal aroma. Just something for you to put in your brain dictionary. Yes, Mom, there you go.
So when you bring the whiskey into your mouth, first...
Hold on, I'm sorry. I keep pausing, but I'm going to do something real quick. I'm going to, open this, and I'm going to see if there's a course on matcha. We're not going to watch it right now, but what if... Please wait. Nope, just kidding. Can't learn about that on this site.
First thing that I do is I try to get around most of the inside of my mouth. Mm-hmm. On the first sip, I tend to try to breathe out a little bit to let the alcohol dissipate. I think right. That's one of the other big mistakes.
How about describing mochi? When you say mochi, I think about Meg's cat. Okay, the first sip. Breathe out. Dissipate. I want you to know that if you know how to do this, you should also take some dance classes because you're probably good at it. You have good coordination if you know what you're doing drinking this.
People make when they drink whiskey for the first time is if you were not drinking whiskey just prior to that, now you've got, you know, this is 46% alcohol volume and above, your mouth is getting used to that. So usually two or three sips in that method, which can kind of help dissipate the alcohol, makes it a lot easier to get used to it.
So it's kind of cleansing or preparing the palate.
Absolutely,
in a way.
Absolutely. And that's something that, again, is not commonly known, but that's a great way to get your palate ready for a true whiskey tasting. But after that, breathing in air, bubbling it through the liquid helps to get those aromas back through the back of your mouth and helps you to smell them better. If you just put it on your palate and swallow immediately,
right,
it'll be a little bit difficult to taste, you know, the chocolate or the nuttiness or the fruitiness.
That's what
you might
I want.
The sweetness or the, you know, the sourness or bitterness, but you'll be missing out on the kind of aromatic notes.
So another thing too, I think
they don't talk about being a barista like this. I've been a barista before, Anakim. I've never been a bartender.
It's kind of important to tell folks when tasting whiskey is that in a way it's kind of circumstantial or by way of everyone has a different life experience. So, you know, you have a lot of guys coming out and saying like, you know, I get forest floor and all kinds of stuff like that. Like, do you think it's important for people to realize like, hey, even though I might taste, you know, some of those fruity notes you're talking about, you may not get those, so on and so forth. I mean, how do you feel about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
Everybody is unique. This is one of the most fun things about whiskey making, but also the most frustrating things that sometimes is that your genetics and your body chemistry are different from mine. So the way that you interpret things or the way that you, your amount of sensory threshold that you have will be different.
Sure.
And it might be a sensory threshold for this flavor compound might be higher, this one might be lower. But when you smell them together, they produce something new entirely.
This guy is Ratatouille.
So it's very, very complex. And I think the truth is, you know, coming back to what I was saying before is don't stress on, you know, have fun and don't stress on thinking, okay, I'm not picking up the orange peel. It smells not like orange peel, it smells like lime peel. Okay,
yeah.
It can smell like lime peel. That might just be the way that you operate. You know, there's some basic categories, I think.
Yeah, now you're gonna know more about whiskey that you can go to your local bar and test your bartenders on this. I wonder if they all know. You guys are getting smart too.
I think that it gets pretty easy to start putting like the caramels and the chocolates and things like
right.
that. But once it gets down to the really finer points of exactly how those are manifested, that's something that is really unique and really individual, and it is based on your life experience.
Dog in the bag.
There's some times when I'm smelling things and I'm instantly transported back to making jam with my parents. Mm-hmm. And, like that kind of red fruity note. And that's like, for me, that's how I interpret it because that's how I grew up.
Right.
For you, it might be totally different.
Indeed. So I mean, like, it's kind of safe to say at this point that there's no wrong answers when tasting, and it's supposed to be kind of fun and explorative and all yeah. those sort of things. And when we talk about people maybe just getting into, say, American single malts, what would be the best way to kind of like train their palate and kind of get them to a point where they're comfortable expressing what they smell or taste?
Absolutely. The best way, I think, in tasting not just American single malts, but all single malts, is find a single malt that you are really, really familiar with, one that you can use almost as your reference standard. Mm. So you get that, you get really familiar with it, know it inside and out, and then when you do a tasting, if you're new to tasting, I think it helps to have that whiskey next to you as this reference that you can move back and
forth. Are you reading this? When tasting multiple whiskeys, cleanse your palate with whiskey.
Forth with another whiskey. So if we were to open up this peated here, mm-hmm. we could have this and the American Oak side by side, where we can taste the differences between the two of them.
I mean, I've seen a lot of tasting wheels going to different distilleries and sitting through a lot of different seminars and whatnot.
Gourmand?
This is definitely very unique. I mean, Gourmand. You guys, you mentioned that you created this yourselves. And what did you have in mind when you created that? I mean, there's a lot of different descriptors on this tasting wheel.
Absolutely.
That I've only seen.
Well, one of the things that we did, because we're doing some things that are pretty different from Scotland, and that we're using some what we call roasted malts, which you're going to bring out.
Well, you shouldn't say that about gin, Grunge. What if you accidentally say that about gin? They're going to be like, no, it's made in stills. Or like, no, we made it in the bathtub on the side of this bar. Like,
more kind of that nutty and chocolatey.
Don't want to offend
right?
anybody.
Never done in Scotland. So when we use that, and then the Belgian yeast again in Scotland, it's all the same yeast strain. And some of these flavor compounds that we were getting in our whiskey were not described by traditional Scottish tasting wheels. They just, like, the flavor notes weren't there.
Right.
So we said, okay, we need to actually create the space that accounts for all these flavor notes that we're
baked,
getting. So that's where we went from.
Sourdough.
Typically there's six categories. We added the seventh, we call the gourmand category, these kind of dessert-like notes where all these things come together.
That's what that is.
But we also put this kind of into we structured it a little bit differently to help, I think, be a little bit more intuitive. Some of them are based, some of the tasting wheels are based on where the flavor notes are coming from. Are they coming from the cask? Are they coming from the malt? And that can be useful in production, but if you're a consumer or if you're out there selling whiskey or anything, ultimately you need to know what the flavor notes actually are. And this is, we think, the best way to help organize those mentally.
So when you're making these whiskeys or you're trying to conceptualize, say, a newer product, like, are you guided by this flavor wheel in a way, or does it kind of change throughout the process? How does that work?
Well, the flavor wheel always stays the same. The flavor wheel is always going to stay the same. So what we want to do is we say, let's try to, you know, take an approach and highlight something in particular. So we just released a whiskey for our Peat Week Festival.
Okay.
And that Peat Week Festival, we did a festival bottling, which we really wanted to highlight a very specific part of the peat flavor wheel, which is funky, earthy, kind of green, fresh peat.
Hold on. Pizza, you think these guys are very particular? You should have seen the vodka girl. She's very particular, too.
We don't...
All these are very complicated.
...normally have in our Westland peated. So this, we were able to look at that and say, okay, these are the things we really want to go for, and we can blend to that. We're not changing anything. There's, you know, it's just a matter of taking those casks and putting them together.
I've just learned that vodka is, like, distilled a ton and can be made from anything that can be made into a mash. Gin, very simple concept. It's all about juniper berries. The whiskey is very, very diverse. They're the most not gatekeeping of the alcohols. Chill Americans, you know, they're not particular. Well, they are and they're not. They're like, you just drink it how you want. Like, here's how I drink it. Here's how I recommend drinking it. But we all, like, we're just here to have a good time. Like, very American. Yeah. And then what was the fourth one we did? Oh, we didn't do a fourth. We just did the basics of bartending.
So this is a great way to kind of help guide us in our process. You know, always come back and look at this. Helps us reinforce it.
Very cool. Well, I'll tell you what, these are amazing whiskeys. They're so different, so vibrant, and really speak to the complexity in tasting whiskey as a whole. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Oh, you're very, very welcome.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Okay. That's it. It's time for the quiz. Okay. Quiz time, everybody. I hope you remembered all of that because I'll probably need your help. Let me make it bigger real fast. Okay. You can help, Dad. Imagine if they switch shirts between cuts. Yeah. Okay. One. What is another name for a highball glass? Collins glass, Nick and Nora glass, coupe glass, or double rocks glass? Highball glass, aka the Collins glass. I'm very surprised I wrote that one, actually. Two, what should you do first during a whiskey tasting? Stick your nose deep in the glass to catch the aromas? Smell the whiskey with your nose about an inch away from the glass? Or take a small sip straight away? I already know that's number two, about an inch away from the glass. Number three, what does burning peat around the grain do to flavor? Adds bitterness, adds a smoky taste, or creates a dry finish? It's not adding bitterness. I think it's creating a dry finish, but I'm not going to move on until someone says something. Was that right? Because I didn't write it. They're like, we basically want to cook. We want to cook this barley. So, smoky taste then? Okay. I'll take your word for it. Okay. I just know it's not bitterness, yeah. What can't bourbon contain? Malted barley, rye, or sweeteners? It cannot contain sweeteners. That was on page number one. Page number one was like, do not do this, do not do that, do not do this, can't do this. It has to be this many years old. What is the minimum proof bourbon must be when it's bottled? I believe that was 80. Must go in bottle at minimum of 80 proof. Yep. Doing good so far. 6. Aside from filtering out impurities, why is oak the best choice for whiskey maturation? It doesn't impart any of its own flavors. It doesn't contain resin that would give unpalatable flavors. It can be used more times than any other type of wood. I believe it doesn't contain resin, right? Because it has to be with new oak. So it can be used more times. Doesn't seem right at all if you want it to be new. You think so, Grunge? I had 4 years of college and I got... You're seeing why I got cum laude is because I took these types of notes. Thanks, Anakin. 7. What kind of barrels does bourbon have to be aged in? New American oak barrels that haven't been charred. Charred! New American oak barrels that have been... Charred. European oak barrels that previously contained sherry. European oak barrels that have been charred. It's one of the first two. I want to say that it is charred. Where did I write that? Oak is a pure wood. I never put if it's supposed to be charred or not. Listen, I don't know. You guys are saying resin would definitely not being in there, but all this, he's like, yeah, this kind of has the same stuff as nail polish remover, and like, if he said, yeah, it has asbestos in it, I'd be like, oh, that sounds fancy. It sounds like a Negroni with Spagliato with Prosecco in it, with asbestos in it. Like, I don't know. I'd believe anything. I don't know anything about alcohol. They had charred ones, but don't know if it had to be charred. New charred. Okay. It seems like you would want that to make it even more smoky. When did bourbon distillation begin in the United States? The 1800s. That was question number one. Literally the first thing I have written is distilled in the U.S. since the 1800s. What happens during malting that is important for the alcoholic content later on? Yeast is released when the grains are germinating. That's a fun word. Enzymes develop during the process or the husk comes off the grain. Well, they gotta crack the grain. But he did say stuff about enzymes. It's not the first one, I don't think, right? Someone answer this question for me. Is it enzymes developed during the process? Malted barley. I didn't write too much during this part because he was talking really fast. Crack grains make wrists. Go with your gut. Absolutely not. The resin question is a tough one, really? I could have sworn he said you don't want it to have, like, this type of wood doesn't have that resin, but because it's new. But the ones for Scotch do, or something. Someone help with that one. Next question. I'll go back to it. What effect can the barrel have on the taste of whiskey? Definitely color. Any flavor, sweetness, acidity. I don't think it's acidity. Peaty flavor sounds right. Sweetness kind of sounds right. I don't remember anything about acidity. I said enzymes. Okay. Okay. I'm going to put enzymes there. And unless someone corrects me here on this one, because it's a... You either get all or nothing, right? Let me know. Oak is known as what kind of wood? It's pure. And it's... Isn't it also porous? It's Okay, I know that it's pure. But it's also porous. And I'm pretty sure it's traditional, too. That seems rude. I know it's pure, though. At least... Oh, sorry, I did this again. At least 51% of the mash bill for bourbon must be water, corn, sugar, or malted barley. For bourbon, I think it's corn. No. Oak is porous. Okay, gotcha. Yeah, it just seems like a trick question. Like, I know that it's pure, but the fact that they even put something that it's kind of also true seems bad. What on earth? Polymer chemistry, material science, resin, and cellulose. That's not helpful. I know that this is corn, but I like to double check anyway. What is the main characteristic of Islay Scotch whiskey? It is peppery, it is peaty, or it is sweet. I want to say peppery, but gosh, I don't remember. Someone help. True or false, bourbon has to be distilled in Bourbon County in Kentucky. It does not. Aside from being generally more affordable, why are the big bourbon brands a great go-to? They are better quality, they are consistently made products, they are easier to find. I'm not gonna say better quality. I'm assuming easier to find, because that makes them a go-to. You're saying consistent? Are you sure? Petey. Okay, well, I told you there was a big chunk in there where I didn't know what was happening. Yeah, please don't. I don't know. After seeing you play Among Us, I don't really know what to believe. Consistent, you remember it? Okay. See, that's the confidence I need. What was one of the main reasons for early whiskey production by Irish and Scottish immigrants? It was to stretch the yield of their crops. I wrote that. And I know for a fact I wrote that. To climb up the social ladder. To partake in bootlegging. Never lied during a moment. Okay, what was the one I was struggling on? This one. Whiskey. Both whiskey. Yeah, I think I'll just do these three. I'm giving you, like, I don't know, 15 seconds to catch up and tell me if I'm wrong. Scotch whiskey should be peaty if I'm wrong. Beat me with a stick. Okay. Number 11. What about number 11? Also, it's porous. I'm sorry, what? No, grunge. Now I don't know. I don't know that I can believe you. I have written right here. It's gonna be backwards. I don't care. It says right here, oak equals pure wood. And then I put porous over here, kind of like as a secondary thing. Pure wood. I can't be wrong on that. Don't mk me. The barrel affects color for sure. Not sure about the others. Yeah, that's where I am. That's where I'm at too. Okay, well, I had to have passed. I have to get 13 out of 16 right, so I passed, and that's what matters. Okay. Let's do it. Let's change to the other thing so that it's bigger. Okay. 3, 2, 1. 15 out of 16. So, what did we get wrong? Can you tell me what I did wrong? I wish it would tell me. Oh, well. That one was wrong. But, he was right about being pure. He was right about being peaty. Right about being consistent. Look at that. Good job, everybody. I don't think I would have passed if I didn't have your help. That's why you guys are here. Claps in chat. We did good. Saving two versions of this certificate. Let's go. Now you know so much more about whiskey and gin and vodka if you were there for that. Real effect on the taste is what we missed. Yes. Ta-da! Now we have four. So next time we do this, we're going to talk about rum. And I think beer. Beer's going to be a big one, though. Let's see. No, not course progress. I want to see the courses. Courses. How could it not be PD, though? I still don't remember what PD means. No. It's not saying that all three of those were wrong. It's just, it won't tell me which specific, you either get all of them right or you get none of them right. Because it implies that if you don't pass the test, you have to do the test again. So it's not going to tell you the right answer. Here, what's that? Oh, can I show you my favorite SNL clip? Because she says, he's like, can I get you champagne? And she's like, or he's like, have you had champagne? And she's like, no, what is it? Cecily Strong, incredible. First date? Is that the name of it? No, not double date. Love at First Sight. This is like my favorite SNL skit. Apparently they messed up so bad in the real one that they had to put the rehearsal on YouTube. So, and I can't even imagine what the actual show one was like. I like rum. You should get Brent to help with a beer one. He knows a lot about all kinds of beers. My life. The champagne of beers? Yeah. Yeah, it's because they couldn't get Beck into the harness. Him. They couldn't get him into the harness in time. They were really struggling. So apparently live, it was like even more of a train wreck. But yeah, that's one of my favorite skits because Cecily rarely ever breaks. Yeah. Ta-da! We've done everything we set out to do. Yeah. Live version must have been painful. I know! I wish I could find it. Let me make sure it's not on there. SNL live version. Yeah. I wonder if someone recorded it. Did someone record it off their TV or something? Dang it. Oh, 80s music video is also very, very good. What the heck? It's 9:03. It's 5 minutes long. I got time for that one, too. And then I'll say goodbye. Yes. Do I know this specific area? I guess it's Brooklyn. I guess this is Brooklyn and not Queens. But the shot looks very familiar. And now my main audience comes to see me. What, you want more SNL next time? Is that what I'm hearing? Let me know. I think you took me there. I took you to this spot? Did we go to Brooklyn? I don't think we went to Brooklyn. Go to my face. Go to my face, yeah. Yeah, so next time is all about, I like how they have latte art, too. It's not just alcohol. It's also barista stuff, like tea mastery. Oh, we got champagne essentials. That's free. Yeah, rum, German beers, espresso coffee drinks, Guinness. Why is draft beer operations $15? Why is it so expensive? Wine knowledge essentials, that seems kind of important. Does Char know that Donald is also Childish Gambino? Absolutely I do. Did you know that Childish and Gambino are both in the same panel of Berserk? And it's kind of a conspiracy theory that Childish Gambino got his name from this one panel in the manga Berserk. And that, oh, is that the song that it's based off of? Or is that a song that he made? I really only know one of his songs. You could probably guess which one. So what's your... chat. Recap. What's your favorite fact that you learned today? about gin or whiskey / bourbon. Tell me. While I do this real fast. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Beer is the champion of bottled beer. We didn't touch on that yet. Donald is a huge weeb. I believe the Berserk theory. I didn't even think about that. No, it can't be. And it's called a Glencairn glass. Yes, I love that fact too, because it's such a cool name. Tinder just messaged me. No, Tinder, go away. I paid no attention. Dang it. We got tequila rose tonight. Let's go. Two fancy new shooter glasses. Next time we do this, I'll also drink it. My fave fact of the day, Char's letter backlog is still too long. Come on, there has to be better than that. I can't think of one specific, we'll have to think on that. I usually don't have to think on stuff like that. I just have certain things that pop out. I'm like, yes, very cool fact. Like, probably for whiskey, my favorite fact about it is that it's just so open-ended. It's very diverse and open-ended, and all the tastes are just very, very different. They're like picky and not picky at the same time. Well, they're not really picky at all. They just know what everything is, and they're not picky about it. Okay, so I'm gonna have us go to someone who will not be raiding out anytime soon. He's on day 60. No, actually, maybe I won't. I won't do him. I'll find someone else. Stay with me. I like that whiskey barrels live and breathe. Oh yeah, that is cool. Are you taking suggestions? What do you mean? I just want to find someone small. I missed a bunch too, which is my main defense. My counselor will agree. Can we all be happy for a second that my stream didn't relaunch? This is one of the first times ever. And because I installed that disconnection protection. Disconnected. No, stress-free with disconnection protection. I gotta make that. I gotta make that a song and put it. When you get the F screen, that video will be put in there. That seems like a good idea. I'm not leaving just yet. Not just yet. Someone's on here saying he's doing karaoke in games. I got two ads. All right, you're staying with me for a few more minutes. You are too chill for bartending. Stressful job. Hey, wait a second. Aren't bartenders supposed to have a very chill vibe to them? And I'm used to doing work-intensive things, like our review group. Consistently, it's been like 6 days, but yeah, we've just celebrated our 2-year stream anniversary. This year, I have a new New Year's resolution, so learning how to bartend is part of that resolution. We're really only focusing on bartending the month of January, and then we move on to something else. I want to tackle something new every month. However, because of this bartending experience I have, I do want to find like a part-time bartending thing. So It could definitely come up more in the future if I get that job, especially. Karaoke, what is this, a bartender stream? No. No, different stream. Brooding, that's like so low effort right there. You're cool with it, nice, just seems stressful. If I know everything, then it should be fine. I'm doing bartending for the whole month, I'll be so smart. If I stream enough, because you know, Infernal rehearsals are starting in less than a week, and I have a lot of new music to learn. The VOD of the Awards is one of the best streams. That VOD of the Awards is one of the best streams of the year so far. I've done like 2 streams. So if that's what you mean, you can bartend at my place. The pay is inconsistent, but you keep all the tips. Well, I don't even know how to pour drinks yet. I haven't done it. I haven't done it with my own 2 hands yet. So, dang it, I always lose followers at that point. Sorry, I'm glad all the rest of you are here, but that is very annoying when you're about to, like, try and show love to someone else.
Tal vez alguien más te la dará. Como la flor, con tanto amor.
He seems like a nice guy. Let's totally do it. Let's do it. Tech Eyeball banned someone. Manageful ban evader. Dang it. Oh man, drinks. Yeah. I can't agree with that. Infernal's gonna hit Broadway and I can see it. When it does that, yeah.
If you're not drunk, ladies and gentlemen, get ready to get fucked up. Let's do it.
Shot, 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 shot